Anthony on satellite radio. Host Anthony Kamiya and Greg Obi.
Controversial team.
And Anthony apologizing for yet another raunchy
comment. Profanity laced rap. Is this the last straw for the raunchy radio duo?
I have a raging heart on.
Let me tell you something about this radio show you listen to. We are really good.
Yeah, man. We hang out. We gonna be all wet. Yeah, man.
We know when we suck. We know when we're great. But we do like when you say how great we are.
Holy shit. Oh, my good golly.
Hey, look, we're broadcasting again.
But enough of this palaver. Let's get the show on the road.
How is everybody on Monday? Good? Did everyone have a good weekend? The Opie and Anthony program. Opie's not in. Let's get that right out of the way.
Yep.
Right out of the way. Opie, not in. I'm guessing excitement overdose. Excitement overdose for Opie. From the USA-Canadian hockey game, the Olympic hockey last night, which, you know, you're not going to get an in-depth analysis from me because I don't really know a lot about the sport. I know, like, you know, Rangers, Islanders don't like each other. When they play, they beat each other up. That's pretty much all I know. Don't know a lot of the technical stuff. Names, don't even try. At this point, they all just sound like 80s bad guys from movies, all their last names. I am Petrenko. It's like, and across the blue line, the guy that burnt Rambo's face with the hot knife. The most talented people I noticed during that hockey game were the announcers. Because that's the Olympic hockey I've heard, a lot different than NHL hockey. If this was the first hockey game you watched, you're going to be gravely disappointed for four more years, apparently. Because, first of all, you watch it without commercials. And that's fantastic.
There's no commercials?
There were no commercials.
Why?
Constant action.
Oh.
Usually, you know, if something gets whistled down, we'll be right back. And then they get a two-second blast for some razor blade. And then they come back. And this, it's just... I'm amazed how long they play without a whistle, without a break. They're changing people like crazy. You know, your team's got the puck, and then you got to do that quick, you know, off the bench, on the bench thing. I don't know how they do that. But exciting as a motherfucker.
Was it really?
It was really. I totally got caught up in it. Now, I could give a shit guy when it comes to the Olympics, especially like Winter Olympics and stuff. I really don't care. Curling, stop. The hockey thing, it ended up being what everyone wanted to see, USA versus Canada. And it was a very exciting game. And I mean, 24 seconds, 26 seconds left, whatever it is, and USA scores to tie it up. That was huge. Huge.
Well, then you know what happened in overtime was...
Yes.
Yeah, Crosby's OT goal kills USA goal dream.
See? Jimmy knows.
Yeah, just... I know, yeah. Pulled out of thin air.
Yeah. Well, yeah, he was the killjoy of the whole thing. So then we had to watch smiling Canadians getting gold medals and very disappointed Americans getting silver. Silver is just the fuck you medal. We were talking about this the other day on the air, and one of the segments on Red Eye that I did on Thursday was, is it worse to get a silver than it is the bronze? Because the bronze... You just miss not getting a medal. So you get the medal, you feel all happy. It's like, oh, if I suck anymore, I'm going home without any medal. The silver, you're going, I just fucking missed the gold.
That's the Jan Brady of medals.
Exactly. The middle child medal.
Yeah
it is. And the Canadians, very happy. Yeah, Crosby, ugh. He put the puck home. Put it past Miller, who, by the way, standing on his head the whole game, as I've heard. Standing on his head. He played an amazing game. Both teams did. I mean, even the Canadians can't call up and say, you know, you beat you. Didn't we? We beat you. Hey, shut it. But they did, and it was in good fashion.
And I'll take the silver, by the way, over the bronze.
Yeah, yeah.
Well, bronze is a lump of shit.
I would, too. It looks like, I bet everybody goes, is that a gold medal? Because it's bronze, and unless you compare it to the gold, you really kind of looks goldish. And then you have to go, oh, no. That's the bronze.
That's third place.
Third place. I just about almost didn't even get a medal.
Do you realize the bronze medal is one step above what you and I got?
Yeah, nothing.
Zero.
We didn't go, we didn't do anything, and got exactly what fourth place got.
Exactly. They just have better abs than we do.
Yeah,
we're
well.
Not, going to have arthritis when we're 50.
Doesn't take much. But very exciting hockey game, I must say. I was sitting there on the couch watching, and when USA scored with seconds left to bring on overtime, I did actually jump up and I went, "Holy shit!" Like, it was just an amazing moment, and I didn't even know why, because I didn't care. I didn't know the team.
Because the Canadians are basically known for their world dominance, and they're colonizing other nations, so it's kind of happy to beat the giant, the big boy.
Yeah.
The bad boy on the block.
Someone's Twitter was just going nutty. Nutty during the game. Everybody tweeting about it. And one tweet I read, and I don't even really get it. It said, well, Canada, thank God you didn't grow cotton or you'd be in as big of shit as we are now. I don't know what it means. I have no idea, but it was my tweet of the evening, I think, that I read.
Yes. Does it have anything to do with the problem that we've encountered in this country because of the abundance of sweaters?
That's what I think it is. Van Heusen even uses it, and we know how horrible their sweaters are.
Yeah, we all know that cotton products are a problem.
Yes.
You have to put them in a different part of the store.
Of course. Sometimes they itch. That shit'll make you itch. But, yeah, that was a quite the funny little tweet. But, again, yeah, Opie out, I guess, that hockey a little too much. He was digging. And he was just beating the living crap out of Canadians. Like, everything Canada was shit as far as his Twitters go. Oh, and then he puts no more Canadian jokes. I guess that was after, you know, we were handed our ass.
Could you picture Opie last night running around in his feety pajamas with hot cocoa, which the sugar will keep you up.
Hot cocoa.
And yelling yay and yay and getting himself all tuckered out and excited.
All sleepy. And then he finally fell asleep on the couch with one button off of the Heine hatch. So it just kind of a triangle came down. And Linz had to put him to bed.
That's right.
Come on now, I'm up. No, you're not. Go to bed.
And then he said he has a cold, so he's like just shitting down the back leg of his feety pajamas.
Just fills them up like big water balloons you're walking on.
Yeah, it looks like he has cankles. Poor sick kid.
Oh, terrible. Yeah, so I got a kick out of that, but I guess we all survived the big snowstorm over the weekend. Wow, let me tell you, Friday, just harrowing on the drive home, and that was a little tweet. Also, my drive down the road, fishtailing my way, almost hitting cabs and vans as I drove down the road, which was a lot of fun. But is everybody in today? Are the roads clear?
Yes,
the roads are clear, but it is Monday. We do know some people don't enjoy Monday. I don't like Mondays. I don't like women. Oh, wait, where did that come from?
I like to play the Bangles. Manic Monday is my theme song.
Yes, it's just another Manic Monday. I wish it was a fun day. Stick it between my bun day.
I wish it were Sunday. That's my cum day.
Yes, I don't like Monday. drove 100 feet, then I had to turn around. Yeah, did you hear what happened with Steve on Friday?
I heard that what happened. Was it a weather incident that kept him out?
Weather-related, absolutely. Everybody else seems to have made it in from near and far. But apparently, Steve C. Had a problem. He got in his vehicle. Don't be mistaken. He gave it his all. Got in the vehicle.
Tried
to get in his
vehicle. No, I mean he made an effort to get to
He tried to drive. He got a measurement of, I believe, 100 feet away from his house. 100 feet. And that was it. That was the last we heard from Steve. That was it. So, here's Steve. Steve, you got...
100 feet.
You got 100 feet from your house. Now, what happened? Was your house in, like, the eye of the storm where it was calm, no snow, and then you actually ran into a giant glacier 100 feet from your house and had a...
Now, I'll preface this by saying, no matter what I say, it's not the right answer.
All right. So very smart.
I've been doing this long enough to know that.
Yeah, and very true.
I live in a condo complex that is off the main road. So the main roads might be plowed. But in that condo complex, nothing got taken care of. So there was like 7 inches of snow on the ground that I was trying to drive through. So I
What vehicle were you using?
My wife's car, actually, because I knew my car would not handle it. So I get in my wife's car, which is it's like a Chevy Cobalt, I think. Has a wider wheelbase.
It's a Cobalt. Who buys the Cobalt?
What is the Cobalt?
What is the Cobalt?
Like
I like cars named after computer language.
Yes. I was going to take the basic, and then I decided to take the Pascal.
I wanted the Chevy DOS prompt.
So now, how did you get 100 feet if...
I have car under carport. No snow in carport.
That's a 100-foot carport?
No.
Yeah, it's a 10-story carport if you're laying on the side.
It's about a 15-foot carport.
All right, now you have 85 feet to account for.
So I gun it, and I fucking slam this thing into reverse as hard as I can, knowing that the only way I'm going to get anywhere is if I just fucking fly down the road.
Right.
Not that it's the
brightest. So you'll just gun it in the carport, and it will just take you straight up to Manhattan. I understand.
At least get enough speed to maybe get out of the complex. In retrospect, bad idea. Because as soon as I take it out of reverse, I'm in a fucking snowbank, and the wheels are spinning, and I cannot fucking move.
And that was it.
And that was it. And I had to leave the car.
Did you pace off 100 feet? Because it was so accurate.
He got 50 feet, and then he counted the 50 feet coming back.
In retrospect, 50 feet is probably more accurate.
Yeah, 50
feet. 50 feet is probably more accurate. I got out of the carport about 3 car lengths, put it into drive, and... car stuck, not moving, and the whole complex didn't get plowed out until about 5 o'clock in the afternoon.
Yes. How long after the wheels actually stopped were you on the phone? I can't make it.
You could hear him in the carport. I'm stuck.
I'm gunning it now.
I was more pissed off that I was stupid enough to get the car stuck. I was in that stupid wheel spinning, not moving anywhere, going, how could I be so fucking stupid? And then,
well,
isolate that.
I did it again.
The best part there, though, was that after he did it and the show was starting, he started calling us and saying, well, I'm not coming in. I guess most of us will have a problem, and we
no,
had to
that's
say,
not true at all.
We had to, no, you assumed.
Oh, not true at all.
Most people,
not even a bit true.
No. I sent that before.
Yay,
no, before
pudding.
I got in the car. Before I got in the car.
No, yay, pudding.
No, after you got out of the car, you did. I am Travis, and say, so who's there? It's probably just you Sam, right? Yeah. And Travis and me had to say, no, it's
that was
Travis and Sam and Danny and Eddie Rock.
When I found out that it was everybody except me
like
and
Mankind
and Mick Foley.
When I found out that it was everybody except for like myself, Mars, and Derek that got in, I was like, oh shit.
Mars didn't make it in.
Yeah. Well, Mars likes to take his days
and
off.
And D-Boy was probably hung over more so than
when I found out it was only that I was one of 3 people who didn't make it in.
I like how he rattled off the other 2 people.
Yeah. Oh, of course he did.
Well, because it's not... Because
me and Derek and
myself and Mel and Scott didn't make it in.
You know, Howard wasn't here either. It was Friday. Oh, yes. Yes.
Eric Logan didn't make his day.
He doesn't work here anymore, Jim.
Tom Chiasano wasn't here.
Bruce from the 80s channel had a problem.
Steve, like you said.
Knowing after I found that out that I was that one of a handful of people that didn't make it in, I was like, oh, I'm going to catch a rash of shit. No, but nobody gives a shit when anybody else doesn't do it. It's the fact that I wasn't here that was the decision.
Now,
and, look, I understand that. I understand that I'm going to get
executive.
I get it.
Like and everybody else. What was your motto as far as the train? Oh, choo-choo go in snow. Choo-choo go in snow.
Yes.
Right. That's what Sam said. Choo-choo go in snow. That was his answer to, wow, how'd you make it in?
Mm-hmm.
Choo-choo go in snow. Sam, you have no choo-choo?
No choo-choo, except down Turnpike, which I can't get to because whole complex not plowed out.
That complex, boy. Jeez. What, do you pay homeowners or some kind of thing? Why wasn't it plowed?
I don't know, but I was on the phone actually with my...
Here's an extra 10. Don't plow my street till 10:30.
I was on the phone with the condo association.
Here's a sawbuck.
I have two fins.
I'll give you an extra 2 bits if you don't plow.
You pay exorbitant fucking condo fees in these areas, especially close to Manhattan, for them specifically to plow.
Where do you live? What, aren't you in South Jersey?
No, I'm right outside of the city.
Oh, I thought you were in
right by where E-Rock lives.
I'm 2 towns over because you've been to my place. You've been to my old place, but my new place is like a block away from that. So it's in that complex that's right off of.
Where's the place?
The not plowed one.
Yes.
Here.
Oh, I thought that was a mountain. Is that a condo development? Yeah. No, I was at the place in South Jersey when I came down to get my CD
done.
South
Jersey, dude.
Where was it?
Hoboken, 2 towns over. I'm not giving away the town I live in.
Yeah. I had to take the ski lift back to my condo.
near Giant Stadium is where I live.
Okay.
Okay.
I'm in Hoboken.
Sorry. Hoboken.
Yeah. All right. I think you were an hour from the city.
Well, you caught a little bit of a ripping, I would say, for not making
a little.
Just a little. We touched on it for probably a minute or two. But it struck a nerve with some of the listeners.
It sure did.
And apparently we have a song parody.
You sure
did. A little tune about Steve.
This is not mocking him, I hope.
Oh, no. This, okay. I think, it's very defending flattering. The fact that his condo was the only condo complex in the world that wasn't plowed that morning.
That is not true. That's an exaggeration.
I don't even think it's so much that it wasn't plowed. I mean, I don't live exactly on a major road or anything, so like all the side streets by my house weren't plowed.
Yeah.
I mean,
you have that fucking Humvee, right? What do you have?
No, I have a Mercury Cougar. That's
that's different. Jesus. Okay. Oh, well, it's four-wheel drive, right?
No.
Just
no?
Two?
No, just two wheels.
Oh, damn. I thought those were big four-wheel drive cars.
We have the song parody. It's by C90 from Twitter.
C90.
And it's called I Would Drive 100 Feet.
All right, let's give it a listen.
I know this song. Yeah. I like this.
When I wake up, yes, I know I'm going to be the man who wakes up next to you. When I go out, yes, I know I'm going to be the man who goes along with you. If I get fat, yes, I know I'm going to be the man who gets fat next to you. And if I'm gay, yes, I know I'm going to be the man who's being gay with you. But I would drive 100 feet, and I would drive 100 more. Unless it's snowing or a Monday, then I won't come into work. When I'm working, yes, I know I'm going to be the man who's working hard for you. And when I ruin things, yes, I know I'm going to be the man who ruins things for you. When I'm eating, yes, I know I'm going to be the man who's eating next to you. And if I'm still gay, yes, I know I'm going to be the man who's being gay with you. But I would drive 100 feet, and I would drive 100 more. Unless it's snowing or a Monday, then I won't come into work. No.
Brilliant. Brilliant. I would drive 100 feet.
And I believe that comes all the way from England, so they're
are you kidding me?
Internationally mocking Steve.
I thought it sounded like he had a little bit of an accent.
I think
there.
He's Irish, actually.
No,
I
Irish. Yeah. He comes from England.
Yes, he's. We have him on the phone. Hello. Yes, I'm from Ireland. It's him.
Remember Corey?
Yes, I do, Sam. Thank you.
I have him every time. Well, you're here today.
Yes, I am.
And what's the big thing today you're working on?
Marriage rep.
Is what? That? Yeah.
Marriage rep?
Marriage rep?
Yeah, I was going through marriage rep for clips.
Marriage rep. Yeah, we got the host of the show. What's
Tom
his name?
Papa will be in today.
Yes, he's in today. New show. Have you seen it?
I have not. I thought it was on. It's after the Olympics.
Neither
I left.
Have I. I don't know what the fuck we're going to do.
Sorry, I know, Tom. I'll just chat.
Yeah.
I'll act like I saw it. But right, Tom. Dude, that thing last time. What was that? And then just lead them.
I'll just say, oh, wow. Now you get the hell out of
yeah,
here.
Maybe I could help. You're out, Tom. He's, no, I saw him the other night at the Cellar. And last night, for some reason, I'm watching the Olympics. Like, after the like, promoing it every 2 minutes.
Oh, yeah.
And then I went home. And I didn't realize it was 10:30 to 11. I don't know why I didn't realize that. It's ooh, fucking 11 o'clock, and I realized I was looking at the guide, and the part where the marriage ref was just to the left.
Oh, don't
where
the time that? I you just realize, oh, I just missed something here. I'm like, I've just missed it.
I'm a dummy.
You weren't perusing last night?
No,
perusing
I was.
Perusing any pornography?
No, I was actually at the Cellar, and then I ate and came back with my girlfriend.
Oh, well.
After eating.
Yeah, that's good.
Yeah. I had to distribute cum.
Nice. You do that, and then you distributed some cum.
I felt it was appropriate to distribute some cum to those who deserve it.
I guess you don't peruse porn when your girl's over the house, right? Not as ridiculously as you would without.
Most of my porn's on the road.
Yeah, yeah.
You're bored. You're
road
in a,
porn, exactly.
In a hotel
or lonely at the house.
Yeah. Oh yeah.
I could relate.
You're perusing on that fucking giant TV. Can you have internet access on that TV?
I could if I plug in my computer to
you
it.
Have
but
to.
I don't, yeah. No, the small screen. If it was a giant screen and I'm just fucking sitting there cranking to fucking giant porno, I'd feel silly.
Do you know how fun a fucking, like a 70s gay porn would look on that?
A big hairy
dude, you
portion.
Have to have gay porn night where everybody comes and watches uncomfortable 70s gay porn.
That would be very uncomfortable.
It would be awful.
Just guys?
Yeah, a bunch of men watching.
Hey, can I come, please? And be invited? Don't put up gay porn, Sam. Porn, I really don't want to look at gay porn.
No, not the hot stuff from today with the twinks. I mean the 70s stuff where it was a man's man.
Yeah, big mustaches and a lot of hair. A lot of hair going on there. I don't know. I peruse porn. Lonely days. Yeah, that's a good one. Thank you, Sam. Yeah, lonely days. And if it's been a while. Then I'll do it. But when you describe, like, just kind of flicking at a flaccid member because you have to.
There's times I've taken my cock and I've just, like, grabbed it by the base and the head's hanging out and I just kind of shake it back and forth. It's like picture shaking a rag doll. That's what my dick is like. It's like nothing is happening.
There's no reason for that, then.
It's not getting hard. It's numb. I'm just shaking a numb piece of skin.
Yeah. I can't quite... Well, grasp that. I can. That it would be pleasurable to do anything like
that.
It's not.
But, you know. It's called escaping.
Yeah.
You know, sometimes you'll have one beer more than you meant to. Like, you know what? I'll have a couple.
You know, now you're putting it in terms I can understand.
You're not thirsty?
No, I just meant to have maybe one or two. And, you know, 8 beers in, I'm going, why am I still drinking this? I'm not thirsty. This isn't something special now. I'm just... You know, shoving beer down my gullet.
8 beers and 1 patent leather shoe in the grill later.
You know, I take cabs now, I swear.
1 sobbing apology to a family later.
I'm a fag these days when it comes to drunk driving. I just can't do it. Too much to lose.
There's 10 years in jail if you tell
somebody. I know. I'm petrified of that. Like, completely petrified. So, if I'm going to be going out, I'll take a cab.
They'd sue you for your house?
Oh, I know.
They'd get it?
I'll take the house. No, I don't need that shit. And then just the thought of, like, you know, going through all that.
oh, the court, and, you know, oh, you were drunk, and this, and then the paper would pick it up, and then I'm automatically a bigger scumbag than I'm perceived now.
Yeah. Oh, the church sex jock kills.
In new DWE fucking controversy, little kid on life support because of me.
Ugh.
No, I'll cab it. Let those crazy Long Island cab drivers drive me around.
And all I'm thinking of is how it would affect me and my mortgage because the show would be in trouble.
Exactly.
I'm not thinking about the victim.
There's probably a morality clause where they'd fire me and not have to pay me anything. I'd be knocking tin again.
Remember me? I was Anthony from the Opie and Anthony show. Yeah, no, I used to do this before I did the radio thing. Yeah, I was a DWE. Nothing. A small apartment down the road. They don't plow it, so I can't come into work. But
yeah, that would be horrible. So I'd rather just cab it these days. And then the cab is great because now I don't even have to think about it. Like, in the bar, I'd be there going, now fuck it. Sure, I'll take that shot. Sure, I'll take that beer.
Can you comprehend going back to another job after this?
No.
I can't either.
It's actually a fear. It's a legitimate phobia I have now of going back to a normal job that, you know, I used to have. I'd say it is up there as my number one fear.
I would have to agree with that.
Yeah.
It's something I think about every day.
Every day.
Every day I think about it.
I think about it.
Scary.
I don't want to do that. I don't want to have to get up and work for, like, a real job and boss and work hard. I did it for years. Now, I know I'm making a lot of friends in the listeners that are right now getting up saying, go fuck yourself.
But no, you're also acknowledging what they do is hard.
Yeah, it sucks. And that I did it. I did it for more years than I did radio. I wonder when I could stop saying that.
You can't hate something unless you've experienced it before.
Yeah.
So I mean, I know what it's like to work shit jobs, and I would probably kill myself.
Yeah, it would be like, I don't know. Not only that, but like people, believe it or not, from what I've said on this show and stuff, I'm not a complete only materialistic guy. I enjoy my toys. I enjoy the pleasures that this great job has offered me through my radio career. But the things that I'm most fearful of is going back to the point where I really have to worry where rent is coming from and if I'm going to have to sleep in my car again, because I had to sleep in my car for a while and stuff. And the, like, it would actually be embarrassing for my family, I think. Not for them. Like, for me to see my family after now completely failing.
And you know that they'd love you anyway and go,
oh, of course they would. And it's like, hey, you had a good run and things like that. And it's like, so what are you doing? Oh, yeah, back in sheet metal work. No, that's good. You know something? It's a good thing you learned a trade. Because now, see, you'd be out with no luck, and now you have a job, and it's great, and you know, put the gun away.
Yeah.
Put the gun.
It's not the end of the world.
It's not the end. And you know, you never know what's going to happen in the future. You could get back or something else, and that to me is like petrifying.
I know comedians who go back to day jobs after 15 years.
Ooh, I know some that should.
But I don't know how you do it. I can't comprehend ever, unless they don't mind because they always kind of kept a foot in that world. But I can't comprehend ever looking back saying I used to just do comedy and now
no.
I do comedy and this because now I have to do this.
Yeah, yeah, I did the job that I really loved doing. You know, when people are like, oh, well, you got a job you love doing, it's not even like working. Shut it. But it's kind of true. So to have to go back to another job would kill me.
The stresses of this job, it's stressful and whatever, but it's nothing compared to even the shitty paying jobs I had were fucking, because you hated it. It was like, I hear people talk about, like, rent money.
Yeah.
And I can't comprehend, not that I can't comprehend it, but it's like, I'm like, God damn, I'm so lucky not to have to worry about, like, is my phone bill going to get paid? Like, I know my phone bill's going to get paid.
Yeah.
My mortgage I worry about. But, like, the phone bill I don't worry about. Like, little shit, like, going out to dinner I don't worry about.
Yeah, yeah, that's, like, the kind of stuff that, and you do. I like how you say lucky, because I say that all the time. It's like, you're so fucking lucky Because there are plenty of people that want to do the job that are not doing the job. But it's like a lucky thing. And I do remember not paying the landlord and him banging on the door and me having to hide. I'm hiding from the landlord so he doesn't kick me out because I spent the rent on slot cars. I was in my 20s. What's wrong with me?
I remember working at a convenience store when I was like 18, back when I was in my wigger phase. When I would wear, I would wear a sky blue Kango to work. I was the worst.
Stop it. And yeah, I don't gots to take your shit, motherfucker.
Yeah, I would say that to old ladies. And then like tough thugs would come in. They'd go, all right. And I'd go, word. Yeah. And I remember in like the meat tray, they had like, yeah, we served meat and cheese and stuff. We had like a little deli counter. There was all these little teeny mouse teeth prints in the fucking food and little balled up hashish turds. The mice were shitting and eating the food. And I told the district manager, Pete, his name was, with a gay porn mustache. He's like, oh, no, that's fine. You can sell it.
You could sell it. And yeah, I could.
I kept not selling it to customers. That was the job I was doing. It was like I had to clean the mouse shit off the food before I sold it to people.
What a horrible place.
It was terrible. So happy I don't do that anymore.
And you did sell it to them?
Once in a while, I would try to turn the meat around.
Like shake your head. No, you don't want this.
Yes. Are you sure you want this? Take a look at it. Just in case I was being tape recorded.
Take a close look.
Yeah, that was a horrible fucking gig.
Just really bad jobs that you just don't want to do, and I couldn't imagine going back to, and it horrifies me. It is the number one fear, because I think of it every day.
I remember the big deal I felt when I missed make. I think it was $3.35 an hour when I started, and then I went to Pergament, and I was driving a forklift, and I remember bragging to people, from Pergament to something else, and I think it was like $7-something an hour. They're like, getting $7-something an hour? I'm like, yeah, man, it's a great fucking gig. And
living large.
Drive me and Joe in a fucking forklift, and I had a big boom, like a giant boom on the front to take 20-foot copper tubing off the back of a truck, and the fucking ramp was broken. Like, rust had rotted out the bottom of the ramp. So if I came down the right side of the ramp, the forklift was going to flip and fall off the dock. So I had to go to the middle left. It was a fucking horrible job.
I can't believe you were a forklift driver.
I was a good forklift operator.
Were you?
I think so. I never killed anyone, and no one ever killed me.
Right? That constitutes a good forklift driver.
The other guys in the warehouse were phenomenal. Like, we were attached to another. It was another trucking company, and I worked for Ciro Copper. And it was just, I was the only one, and I would have to, like, these flatbeds outdoors in January, 10 degrees out.
Oh, I know, yeah.
Unloading fucking 20-foot giant long bundles of copper tubing. It was a fucking horrible job. It was a tough job. You have to go on the truck and lift shit. It was fucking freezing.
And wrap the cold metal is
awful
in the winter. For some reason, metal gets colder than outside is. I don't know how it happens. But, like, you'll be outside and just go, it's really fucking cold out. And then you go to grab metal and go, why did they refrigerate the metal? It's colder than outside. With sheet metal, was the same thing, like working sheet metal jobs. You'd have to load the trucks up with these fucking ductwork that was freezing cold, get to the job site, and then there's people that just are into it. Like this one guy I worked for, I was his helper. I was his fucking helper. And I had to, like, get stuff and help him, like, put the ductwork up and everything. And he was gung-ho guy.
Ugh.
Like, every morning I'd be drinking my coffee in the van or something, and he'd be like, all right, come on, let's start up. It's 7:30 on the dot. It was like, come on, we got to start up right now. And he used to make, this was the gayest thing. He'd make me, because he couldn't reach around behind him to tie his little apron. Yeah, his little nail apron. So one of my jobs in the morning was to tie his nail apron on.
Ew.
How fucking subservient, like, is that? Because it's right over his ass.
You're a sheet metal cuckold.
I prepped the fucking boss.
Wait, was he an ex-drinker? That sounds like an ex-drinker. Or was he an active drinker?
I have no idea. He drank some beers, okay. but I don't know if he was a drunk or not. You know, by my standards, nobody is.
Yeah, and William Holden was a fucking teetotaler.
But he'd be like, all right, let's suit up. Like, suit up. I'd put a nail apron on and put a hammer in my fucking belt. But he'd be like, all right. So, and he'd stand up and, like, fucking putting the robes around a fucking Caesar. I had to dress him in his armor. and put this on, and I felt so degraded every day having to tie that bow, tied that little bow. All right, a little tighter. That's good. Is it? Is it good? And that's what I had to do. And then he would tell me what I had to do, like, all day. All right, get me that. I need three of these. Go to the truck and pick up. Put more gas in the generator. And I'd be freezing cold, just wishing I could have a better job. And it's horrifying, the thought of having to go back to
that. Dude, I drove by that place, that old copper. It's out of business now. It might be still be. I think
well, you left. You were the best forklift driver this side of the Mississippi.
From Portland, Oregon, or Portland, Maine, for that matter. And it was, I remember me and my boss, there was this
yay pudding.
Oh, Dan.
Oh, I hope it really is, too. No, please. It's appropriate. There was a hooker named Pam, a black girl, who walked behind the thing, and she was, like, not even an attractive hooker. She was, like, just wore dungarees and a fucking, you know, like just a she was a drug addict hooker. And so she had sucked my dick or whatever.
Ooh.
And so she was going to suck the guys at work, the supervisor. He was an older guy. He was a big, fat guy. He was in his 50s. And
it was still went on even when you just worked at a regular
job. This is when
job.
I was fucking 22 years old. Hysterical. Or 21. I hadn't even done comedy yet. And we worked, like, we had, like, a little office inside a giant warehouse which belonged to another company. So we rented warehouse space from another bigger company. So our office was kind of closed off. So the hooker walked in, and she was going to take care of him. And he would always go, okay, Jim, I'll see you Monday. Yeah, I'll see you Monday, Jim. Just a big fat dude. I come back in Monday, I'm like, how was it? He goes, Jim, she stole my wallet. This dummy. I go, what happened? I'm like, I told you to put your wallet, because I did tell him, put your wallet in the desk drawer. Don't leave it in the back of your pants, or just take your dick out. He goes,
shit.
This is how naive he was. He goes, no. He goes, you know, I pulled my pants down on my ankles and sat back, you know, because I wanted her to enjoy the experience.
Oh, she's going to enjoy
I'm
it.
I'm like, you're morbidly obese. You're in your 60s. And she's sucking your dick so that she doesn't shake apart from lack of drugs. How much fun is she having, fucking anchovy balls? She's not having fun, old man.
And she did the gag when she reached into his pulled down pants pocket and took his wallet
out. Awful. They were probably turned inside out because, you know, fatty. I bet he had his pants pulled down to his shoes and his black socks slumped to his fucking his fat calves.
With those old 50s garters on?
Yeah, little sock garters holding them on.
And, how easy must it be for a girl to pick a pocket that is around someone's ankles?
Dude, if you could fucking pick his pocket, you could tie his shoes together. She probably could have rifled through his wallet and picked out the credit card she was going to use. What a dope.
What an idiot.
Yeah, but I'll never forget that, because I think she had sucked my dick in the car one time, and then I'm like, yeah, she gives a great blowjob. I had awful fucking regular hookers back then.
Would she come around like the coffee truck?
They would actually. Like really? A lot lizard. Yeah, she would probably stop in. We were in the back of we were behind. I should go and get photos of this place one day. It really was a fucking horrible back of the lot place. It was really an isolated place. Yeah.
I look at certain places when I drive home now and stuff like warehouses. You can see, driving through Queens, the garage doors are open and you see guys working in there. And I look in and think, like, how horrible that is, but how familiar it becomes to you when you do work there.
Yeah.
Like, when you first go in and I'd apply for one of these shit jobs, you look around, everything's unfamiliar, and then you just get into this rut where you're coming, you know where everything is, you know who everyone is, you know your shit fucking job will be that day, and it just becomes so goddamn depressing to do on a daily basis.
Yeah, what seems like you'll never make it a part of your comfort zone, like I'll never feel at home in that place, and then you do, and then you grow to hate it.
Yeah, you know every nook and cranny, and you try to have fun with people, and maybe you'll have a few laughs during the day, and then realize, though, that it just sucks being there.
It's weird the things you remember from I remember when I worked at Pergamon before that, this is when I was just getting sober, so it's probably 1987 in that area. I drove a forklift in the back, and this was the new Pergamon in the Brunswick Shopping Center.
Whoa.
This was like a fucking cheese dick lame, like, little fucking one-level mall that opened in North Brunswick. That half the stores, it was called the Fashion Plaza. There was nothing fashionable about it. Pergamon was one of the anchor stores in the Fashion Plaza.
Pergamon in a fashion
exactly.
Plaza.
It's fucking horrible. And I'll never forget my supervisor there was a very, very fat lesbian who had tattoos. And when she wanted me to go buy food, she'd always, like, get me to go, and she'd pay, and she'd always go, you fly, I'll buy.
Oh. And I always remembered that. And for some reason, my girlfriend was going to, I wanted her to walk to get something. And I almost said, you fly, I'll buy. And I didn't say it because I pay for everything. Yeah. So even if I fly, I'll buy.
You're constantly buying. But it just would have never flies.
It just would have seemed too, because it's not a coworker. It's a girl I fuck.
Yeah.
But I remember this black guy, Malcolm.
You suck, I'll pull out a buck.
Yeah, you fuck, I'll pay a few bucks. Even if you don't fuck, I'll pay a few bucks. Because I'm hungry. What am I going to do, eat in front of you?
Shit. But the coffee trucks would come by. And I would just be starving and have no money and have to take a tab out with the guy. And there's nothing worse than being into alone with the fucking mobbed up coffee truck guy for egg sandwiches that we used to say made at some place in Central Islip. And I knew Central Islip is Zimbabwe.
Yeah.
It is just an awful place. I used to live there. It's horrid. And I'd look at these sandwiches, these egg sandwiches, and just be like, between hunger and this is how I know that if I was on that fucking plane crash from Alive, I'd have been the first one just mowing down on someone's dead ass, just eating it. Cause I would pick up these egg sandwiches knowing where they came from, probably being spit on.
Yeah.
And just eat it, not thinking twice. Like the hunger. And believe me, it wasn't like hunger like days have gone by, but the hunger just made me forget the fact that this food is probably being touched and abused by people.
What's worse than when you get to a new job? I had a temp job one time. I was such a fucking bum. And I was so bad at this stuff. This is when I was drinking. I was me and my buddy Bill D'Angelo. And Bill, if you're listening, I got your message.
Hello, Bill.
We were doing this job in fucking, it was like a warehouse. It was like centrifuges. And what is worse than having to shit on a new job
where you know
the bathroom is awful and like you like your whole stomach seizes up? And you know that when you're trying to hold in a shit and you're standing there and you go,
I don't think I've made the sound, but I know the feeling.
You don't make the sound, but the feeling of a, like, you know, I just want to talk. And you get really stiff and you can't walk because one step and you're going to shit. What's worse than having to shit at a new job? There's nothing worse.
You don't want to. First of all, you don't even want to go away from what you're supposed to be doing for fear you'll look at like you're lazy.
Yeah, you don't want to have to.
You don't want to do that. And then, the uncomfortable, what's the best bowl? You haven't figured out what's the best toilet yet.
Because I like a long shit. Like, I'm the worst. Like, whenever I go to shit, everyone who knows that I was just there knows I've been shitting.
Because
I'm gone too long to have been pissing. I like a relaxing shit.
Yeah.
Yeah, and on the job, you just can't do that.
They should have some kind of, I'm going to invent this, pants that cuff up inside the pant leg. So as you're walking, doesn't look like anything. It's just pants. But you could pull down artificial shoe tops that will go over your shoes so that when you're shitting in the stall and people come by, it doesn't look like your shoes. Because the people look at your shoes to see who's shitting there. I know it happened to me a couple of times. It's like, oh, I had a good dump in there, did you? And I'm like, fucking 5'11 boots. Everyone knows them. So fake shoe tops. I'll call them shit spats. Spats. They're fucking spats.
What a great infomercial that would be.
Oh.
You show people talking about the advantages of no one knowing it was you shitting.
Shitting.
You know, my boss, I would never get raises. As soon as they didn't think it was me stinking up the bathroom, I advanced in the company. You know, testimonials.
And they can have like that badly acted thing where someone's on the bowl shitting and the boss comes in, sees the shoes, and shakes his head. Ah, Smith, it's you again. Is that account going to be completed by today? And he knows it's him.
Yeah, and the boss and like the pretty secretary are both just looking at Smith's empty chair.
Someone says they should be called splats. Oh, it's Steve from Bayshore. Splats! the audience applauding. Oh, yeah, I could use that. I shit a lot.
Yeah.
Yes, I do.
Yeah, they take the fucking... I love the idea of him and the hot secretary just both noticing that Smith has gone again.
Smith's gone again, and the newspaper's gone. You know, whoever has read the newspaper at a urinal, you don't. You fucking, it's gonna, I am gonna be shitting for a long time.
And they can't say shit, so they have to do little things to get around it. Like they have a little thing that says clothespin bin, and it's empty, and they're all wearing them on their noses in the office.
Is that Smith again?
Yeah, that damn Smith and his colon cancer.
He can't finish the O'Reilly account because he's shitting again.
And they allude to it in the office, like, yeah, we're going to have to move Smith's desk into there. God damn, that's Smith.
Oh, he stinks.
Oh, that was wonderful.
That's wonderful. It's certainly. Oh, my God. I haven't even gone to a phone call. What am I thinking?
Yeah, let's take a phone call from somebody.
All right, Christine, because she's a girl.
Hey, good morning, guys. How are you?
Hi. You're in Howard Beach, huh?
Yeah.
Rock. How's the Howard Beach?
Excuse me.
Out
who
days?
Is that? Wow.
Oh boy, there's a girl on that.
Holy
Channel 11
mackerel,
news.
Is she hot?
Oh, I think that's that chick.
Jesus.
Yeah. Wait a minute.
Not fatty. Who's the other name. One? Sorry, sweetheart.
What's she doing? She gives
Kanye
Christian.
Oh, the one with the lips.
Yeah.
Who is she? God, did she wear a little skirt?
She looks about 19.
Well, yeah, she's an adult. God damn, yeah, she's fantastic.
It's like, yeah, she's an adult.
Yeah, in certain countries.
She passes muster.
Wow, is she pretty.
Yeah, oh, apparently a model.
God, oh, nor does she's attractive, right?
God damn, yeah. We're just watching her now. She's wearing a little blue boy shorts and fucking... I don't like the name boy shorts, by the way. I love boy shorts.
Yeah.
Hate the name. It's like, oh, she was wearing boy shorts. It's like, why are they going to put the word boy in there?
She's a model. Her breath probably smells like vomit and cherry Coke. Because models always make themselves puke when they drink cherry Coke. So they think nobody will notice. It's like, we got it, fucking Ribs McGillicuddy. I'm sorry. What were you saying? I apologize.
Yes, Christine.
Ribs McGillicuddy related to anus?
Ah, linger a bit longer from last week. We got a real listener here. Howard Beach. Any black people in Howard Beach?
Ew.
All right.
I
any available houses?
No, their health doesn't allow it.
So what do you got for us today, Christine?
No, I don't want to take you out of your North Shore palace environment, but boy, would I love to see you in jeans and a tool belt with a hammer.
Oh, yes. Back in the old days, I used to sling quite the tin-knocking hammer there, Christine, and my little tool belt with my little sheet metal screws filling it up and my cold little fingers trying to pick little sheet metal screws out of there and put it in the Makita drill, and then it would slip off, and a lot of times I'd bash my hand against cold metal.
Would you be annoyed?
I would go home.
You would?
I went home anytime I felt the least bit of pain from work. I would pack it up, I'm going home. This was after the helper portion when I became like the boss guy.
Oh, really?
And I was a good boss guy for helpers because they didn't have to do anything. I would listen to a certain radio host until like 11 o'clock in the morning in my van, just reading the paper, not doing any work. And then I would go to work, which lasted till noon. So that was a good hour. And then lunch was till about 2 p.m. And then another hour of work. And then, God, you got to clean up. So I would clean up. So about a good 2 hours work. I'd put in on a daily basis.
Sounds to me like this guy shouldn't get no Employee of the Year awards.
Oh, Chip, I didn't. Oh, my God.
So what, sweetheart?
Yeah.
Oh, no, I was just having the Anthony tool belt.
So you think Anthony would look good? Maybe with a tool belt. Perhaps a pair of white socks and work boots and no trousers or underpants. Just his giant, delicious dick swinging below that belt.
I thought that's what she meant by my hammer.
No, she meant a real hammer. She's a girl with low self-esteem. She likes to be taken by force. She wants you to claw and hammer in her fucking forehead.
Claw hammer, that's always hot.
That's because she lives in Howard Beach, so we right off the bat, we got something in common there, Christine.
Big hair?
Well, that, yes, but, you know, also our, let's just say our opinion on certain people.
Then you also do not believe in any type of ethnic diversity. Very lovely.
Yeah, I'm pretty much a what they call a separatist. You nice white girl?
Yes, I am.
Oh, that's great. You've only bed with white people?
Only them Italians.
Oh,
have you ever laid down with a... That's how you know someone's racist. When they're asking, when they're asking if you ever had sex with a black Irish Spanish guy, and they use the term lay down. You ever laid down with a color? You ever laid down with someone from Central America? It's like 60s, awful 50s and 60s racist.
So apparently you still have some type of relationship with your dad. Sorry if he's dead. I hate when they say that.
Oh, no,
of course not.
It was lovely speaking to you.
It certainly was, Christine.
Have a good day.
Thank you for checking in.
David Patterson on the news. Oh, they took him off the news.
Yeah, I know. Well, they're taking him off more than the news.
Dude, that's a shock. He's fucking not running.
Yeah, wow. He said earlier, though, like about a month ago, that nothing is going to stop him from running. And, wow.
Yeah.
I guess they found something.
Except something he bangs his shins into.
Yeah.
Nothing is going to stop me from running if I'm in a field with soft things around me.
He, it's, again, the illustrious governor of New York who inherited the job, because he was lieutenant governor, from Eliot Spitzer.
Yes.
Who, wow, did this guy trip over his dick on his way to political glory. He was the guy who was getting hookers, and they kind of threw him out. And then we got David Patterson, the blind African-American gentleman.
Yeah, he's a what, and he's what?
That right.
Was the reaction.
And he's been in there just doing a horrible job at being governor. He, of course, very tough times. A lot of governors have taken flack. Schwarzenegger's taking a lot of shit in California. But these are hard times. But his answer to hard times is to tax soda.
And he's also, don't forget, he had a sexual scandal when he first started, too. But he just admitted all of it and got it out of the way.
He got it out of the way immediately because he knew that was going to be coming out.
Yeah.
But now it seems one of his staffers, this giant gentleman of 6'7".
Yeah.
What is he, a bodyguard? A driver?
His driver. I imagine his personal bodyguard and assistant. He probably takes care of his everything.
So it's like Grape Soda Kenny, he'd call him.
Oh, that's a fucking good
one.
God damn it.
He's a big guy, and he was involved in some kind of hijinks where he was with his girl.
Grape Soda Kenny. I'm going to laugh all fucking afternoon about that.
And he was involved in shenanigans where he was in a domestic dispute with his girlfriend, wife. I don't even know what it was.
Is that who it was? I thought it was a stranger.
Chick.
Oh, okay.
It was his chick he was with or something. And the girl called 911 and said, "This guy is choking me." And he could be heard in the background saying, "No, I didn't. I'm not." And they went back and forth going, "Yes, you did. No, I didn't. Yes, you did. No, I didn't." In a very mature 911 call. But they'll always take the girl's side of the story, by the way.
Yeah.
And this guy, again, 6'7". I don't know how big the girl was, but she didn't look 6'7". And since he was the governor's buddy, there are allegations now being made that the governor, along with some police officials, used their power to hide the whole thing and get the guy out of this jam-up that he was in for domestic violence. And that is why the governor is not going to run for re-election.
And I'll tell you, this is where it's like black and white doesn't mean anything.
According to him, it's all based on race.
Yeah, Patterson should shut the fuck up with his dopey Simpson cartoon upper lip, that big dopey, stupid, sticking straight out retard upper lip he has. And it's not what a fucking dummy. It's like on that level of politics, any of this shit like can derail you, and any type of a sexual scandal. It took Spitzer out,
and they will find out.
Of course, they will.
In this day and age, all this modern technology and people that can turn a quick buck, turning people in, it happens. And this guy's had some shady dealings in the past. He's done. He's gone. His political career, done.
Even Obama walked away from his racial... Patterson is one of those guys. He's a fucking baby because he complained that it was race. He's like, well, that's why they're saying that I kind of lucked into the gig. Lyndon Johnson was always kind of seen as the accidental president because of Kennedy's death.
Yeah.
So, and that's just the way it is when you kind of get into a gig through less than being elected standards.
Yeah.
So that's why he was looked at... Not because he was black. What a fucking baby.
Look at what Gerald Ford went through. You know, he was goofed on his entire presidency because he was another one that no one voted him in as president. He wasn't voted in.
How did he get it? Was it Nixon's?
Spiro Agnew had to retire because he had some tax problems. And then Ford got in there as vice president. And then when Nixon resigned, Ford stepped up and became president.
Oh, right. Okay. But I didn't. That's right. I forgot he kind of got in because of.
Yeah, he kind of slipped right in there. No one. He was never elected president of the United States.
What position was he in?
I'm not sure what he did before that.
Not even vice president, right?
No, he wasn't vice president. He was. I think when the vice president resigns, the president can then appoint a vice president.
Okay.
It's either the president or Congress. I'm not sure who does it. I'm not that fucking geeky as far as Representative Michigan's
Fifth
Congress District 8th as the Republican minority leader. I don't know. Whatever it was, he got the gig and was goofed on the entire time.
Because he was falling down the steps.
He would fall down Air Force One stairs.
Idiot.
The guy was a klutzy schmuck.
Do you ever find footage of Gerald Ford falling?
Oh, it's hysterical.
The only time he didn't fall is when Squeaky Fromm pointed a gun at him, but I think he jumped up with a target painted on his chest, an idiot.
That Squeaky got around, didn't she?
She really was a fucking bad citizen. What a bad citizen. What a cunt. She's involved in the Manson murders, and then didn't she have a gun? What was her thing, like, where the Secret Service stepped in and didn't the guy put his fucking hand so she couldn't fire?
The webbing between his thumb and his pointer finger right in between the firing pin on the hammer and the gun, and it snapped shut on his hand and pretty much saved
Gerald Ford's life, right?
Life. Yeah.
Now, here's footage of him falling. He's walking
he's holding an umbrella.
Him and Betty Ford.
Betty Ford.
He slips.
There he goes. Oh, did he fall on his ass?
He slid down some wet steps. About 8 fucking steps.
Oh, and they try to help him up.
That's great.
Fucking Betty Ford's hammered and she didn't fall.
I know. At least, it's great with her white gloves.
Oh, God.
How humiliating.
Damn. He slipped. Oh, they used to just rag him relentlessly.
Was that his only trip, or was there another one? There had to be another one.
There was another. Yeah, there was. He was constantly falling down.
That's great.
And then there was another time he was eating tamales in Mexico with the Mexican president, and he picked the whole thing up. Now tamales, I guess, are served in corn husks. But you're not supposed to eat the corn husk. You eat out of it. And he picked the thing up and started eating the corn husk and had to be told not to do that.
Fucking foreigners. No one knows how to eat their food.
No, they're dumb food. Stop it. Don't put it in that. At least we make edible bowls. Nice soup and a nice big hollowed out bread.
Oh,
you can eat the bowl. It's fun.
It's great. They should do that with the toilet. So Patterson is going to be gone in 10 months.
Yes.
And I guess that's...
Yeah. Gone.
Did you guys talk about... I want to peek. We peek. I got to
piss
badly.
We'll take a little break.
And also, did you talk about the SeaWorld lady? Was that over the weekend? Or
We could touch on that again, though, because the fact is they pretty much hose it down and, you know, business as usual. So we'll talk about that. What else is going on, Dan? I see you've got some fun things in front of you. And there's great stories going on. We have our guest coming in.
Don't forget we have the major earthquake that went down in Chile.
Yes, Chile. And, wow, tears in my eyes at the premiere of the We Are the World video on YouTube.
I've not seen it.
Well, it is fabulous. We'll tell you how you can see it when we come back from these words.
How can I be so fucking stupid?
Yes.
Ooh, this is rocking.
A little hole in the sky.
It's not nice.
Of course.
Yeah. Just wait for the vocals to take in.
They do.
Can we please start just playing full songs?
They won't. Watch.
Oh, no, wait. It's not supposed to be yet.
Not yet.
It's me being eager.
This is good, man.
Opening show up to Sabotage.
All right, here we go. Here we go.
Oops.
Well, we all know that wasn't going to happen.
That's the live version.
Opie and Anthony show. Opie's out. Out today. Like I said, hockey OD or something. He was tweeting like a mad person last night. Who's bashing Canada?
I think little Opie got too excited and put some excited hockey pudding in his underpants. And felt. I think he fell asleep on the bed, face down with his arms at his side, and his little feet sticking off the end of the bed, like when a little kid just collapses on the bed.
Just fall down. He needed to go to bed, you buy.
I want a quick plug, too. Tonight I'll be on Red Eye, and tomorrow night I'll be on Joy Behar. Those are my TV plugs. And then the 12th, and 2 weeks from now, I'll be in Chicago area, so check.
Oh.
Unless you're busy, then don't check.
How did your Cleveland gigs go?
It was good. It's fucking snowstorm. Me and Kenny leave. I didn't want to leave on Thursday early.
Mm-hmm.
We had to leave early because we're getting, 6 feet of snow.
Yeah.
We're sitting on the runway. We're in the thing. It's snowing really fucking heavily. Like, I'm like, we're not going to take off.
Were you just freaking out?
Dude, they were canceling flights, so they kept piling people on our thing. There was a pilot I was sitting 2 seats away from on as a passenger, and he's like, man, he's like, they're not going to take any flights off after this. So we're ready to back out.
A pilot said that to you?
Because the snow was so bad.
Oh, right. That's pretty good information.
And then we have to wait for de-icing to get in line for the de-icing. So the pilot gets over the loudspeaker. He goes, all right, look, our spot is open for de-icing. And then we're just sitting there. I'm like, what the fuck are we doing? Turns out there's a maintenance issue because the door won't close. It's just ice. It's like, we're not taking off. So we take off hour and a half late. We get into Cleveland. It's snow. It's horrible. Turns out my original flight was 40 minutes late. I could have stayed and did the show and left the show. I was so irritated.
You still would have gotten there.
No problem. Nothing. It would have been no issue.
You fucking waited on the runway.
I couldn't help it. I listened to fucking Panicky Pete.
We best get there early.
Yeah, they say.
They couldn't close the door because of ice?
One of the bay doors wouldn't close, which was probably, I think, the luggage stuff.
Jesus Christ.
And it was just an issue of
that's
ice.
That's icing up pretty quick when...
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, they want...
Were you a little nervous taking off? Were you looking at the leading edge of your wing?
I know.
Going,
It was so bad, though. It was so bad that the way they had to structure it was you had to get de-iced and then go right to the runway and take off. Yeah. There was no line.
Yeah.
So when they were de-icing, they missed some spot on the wing. And I'm saying to the pilot who was sitting next to the window, I'm like,
hey, pal.
Yeah, I'm like, did they miss that? And he's like, they're going to come back and get it. They give it a second pass over.
Oh, really?
But then he looked out a couple times, and they did come back, and they knocked it off the wing.
He's probably like, yeah, all right, don't worry. They come back. Hope they come back.
I was so happy he was there. If there was still ice on the wing and they pulled away, I would have stood up and said, madam, there's ice on the wing.
Knowing you, I just could picture Jimmy's little silly kid questions. Hey, mister, what was that sound?
Dude,
the landing gear. Like, just annoying this poor pilot who just is trying to get to Cleveland.
I love sitting next to... All I want to do is ask big flying questions. Do you get scared when there's turbulence?
Why don't the wings just fall off? Yeah, well, they're...
I should be sitting in knickers, licking a fucking lollipop with swirly stuff on. You know a swirly pattern
yes,
lollipop?
Swirly big, a big lollipop.
With a little fucking Angus Young hat.
Hey, mister.
Mister, why does the plane go so fast?
Can I wear your hat? It gives you a little wings and touches your wee-wee.
Yeah, and I get confused because it feels good, but I know it's wrong because he put a blanket on me and I'm not even cold. He massages my boyish knees. It's great. Right into pedophile humor.
Jesus Christ.
Thank you, Kenny.
Yeah, so Jimmy on Red Eye this evening.
I'll be on tonight, and I don't know who I'm on. How was your Red Eye? You did it Thursday.
Very fun. What a blast those guys are. I like the new setup, too. Four guests at the table, plus Greg at the table. And it was really good. I mean, I like it that way. Then you don't... It's kind of awkward when you have to go down into that newsroom.
Yeah, I hate the newsroom.
And talking to just some camera... With a light in your face. But in the newsroom was Odorous was there as the intergalactic correspondent.
Oh, they didn't put him in the chair?
Really funny. God damn. No, I don't think they ever put him upstairs. Really?
No, you're right. They didn't. No, you're right.
They put him in the newsroom, and they have graphics for him now. Intergalactic correspondent. And he sits there just being so obnoxious and hysterically funny.
What is funnier than that fucking robot thing? Have you ever seen the robot thing that they do on Red Eye?
Yeah,
robot theater?
Yeah,
that
robot theater.
Hilarious.
They, I heard they were getting a little bit of shit for it.
Why?
But I don't know. Some people give you shit for anything, but they're fine with it. They just keep rolling
it's
right
really
along.
It's really funny.
And I didn't get edited at all this time, which was good. I actually got to say the word pud. I use the word PUD on the air. And as I'm writing, because with Red Eye, you got to kind of write.
Yeah.
You got to, they give you subjects and topics, and you got to kind of, you know, just basic ideas.
Yeah.
So me, I'm horrible because I'm in a fucking hotel. Whenever I do Red Eye, I stay in a hotel, and I get the subject matter at about, what, 4:30?
Yeah, about that.
And it's got to be in by about 6 or so. So I'm on my laptop, laying in bed on the computer with the TV on, trying to watch TV,
yeah,
drinking beer, like just thinking like, I got nothing on that.
Yep.
I got nothing. And I'll keep reading it over and over again, and then finally like something might click. Hey, type it down. Okay, I covered one subject. 8 more to go.
Sometimes I have I try to get one joke per topic at least. Sometimes
that's
all you can get. That's
pretty much it. Just one, you know, one good one per topic. And then for the rest, you could usually wing it, you know, a little bit, at least to lead up to your joke, you know, so it doesn't sound like you're just reading jokes.
Yeah, you can do it. It's okay to have a real opinion there, too. It's like you don't have to always be. Gutfeld's a great host.
Huddler. Yeah. Gutfeld's great, man. He had a fucking problem that was hysterical. I guess the makeup girl got makeup in his eye. So he starts the show and he's talking and we're looking at him and a fucking, like from the movie Ghost, a tear just slowly goes down his cheek. He's crying.
He said it was makeup. I think a memory resurfaced. He said it was makeup. It was really like creepy neighbor.
He starts crying.
Oh, poor sweetie.
And thank God, one of the guests, I can't remember his name, was like, Greg, are you crying? And then that became a subject for you. But I was going to leave it alone. I'm just looking, going, oh, my God, he's crying on television.
This is a little uncomfortable.
Yes, very uncomfortable. Reminds me of me. I'm looking for spaghetti on the wall. Maybe that's why he's crying.
He has a new book out, too. I don't know if it's out yet, so I don't want to plug it yet, so I should maybe just shut up. I want to wait until he can actually get credit on the... Yay! Pudding!
I never realized how many farts per day we get until now it has a phrase.
It has to have a phrase. I won't Twitter anymore.
Pudding. What the hell were we getting into before the break?
We were going to talk about...
Oh, we were talking about the... first of all, We Are the World, right. That video is available. Sam, I want to give credit where credit is due. Did you have total say over the production of this video?
Did
you edit it?
I filmed, edited, produced everything.
Everything.
The entire video is mine.
Bang up job. It, I think, evokes the emotion due this song. We Are the World, over the years, whether it's the 25-year-old version or the new shitty version, does bring emotion. It does. It's only brought out for a purpose. You don't just bring that song out for, you know, hey, it's been 10 years. 10-year anniversary of We Are the World, did it come out?
No.
No, what was happening? Who cared?
Big deal.
Nothing. Now we have the Haiti earthquake, so they all decided to get together and put out a really shitty version with auto-tuning and rap.
I did like this version, by the way. I don't like the auto-tuning, but I didn't mind the rap.
I liked our version.
It's better.
Of We Are the World. The video is now done, and it is up, and getting rave reviews. I'm looking over. I see a lot of red stars right there underneath it.
You're tracking 5 stars, and this went up Friday night, so with no in-show promotion.
No in-show promotion.
Quickly approaching 25,000 views.
See, that is amazing. Just word of mouth, maybe a couple of tweets here and there. But when I watched it, I actual tears coming out of my eyes from laughing.
Okay.
It had nothing to do with the emotion put forth by these fucking retards trying to sing. to see Big A struggling through his vocals, to see Pat Fromanaki's rosacea head, to see Sandy Kane in all her vaudevillian prostitute look. Classic.
Club Soda Kenny looking directly at the camera lens.
When he goes, for you and me, and he points to himself in the crowd like he really meant it.
Who said that?
Kenny.
I haven't seen it.
It is hard. What we'll do, I guess, is play the song, because you got to hear it.
Yeah.
And we here will play the video, if you could sync it up. My God. Maybe we'll play right off the goddamn...
We'll play it off the YouTube.
Play it off the goddamn... Just unplug the goddamn thing. We'll play it right off the
play,
magic.
Pig-eyed sack of shit.
I'd expect man for more.
The magic of the computer.
I was going to say I'd expect more from a man, but I have egg in my mouth. I said I'd expect man from a more.
Now you have egg on your face,
I sure
friend,
do.
Figuratively speaking.
A little helping of humble pie.
Oh, Jim. And, a few people make appearances. Ted Sheckler is in there.
People are saying a lot of people, this is the first time they got to see Ted Sheckler.
To see Ted Sheckler. Yeah, a lot of comments are to actual see. You know, people have heard Ted Sheckler on this program many, many times.
Sure they have.
To see Ted's face. To see the face that is needed to make that fucking voice.
Yeah.
And again, also comments on Steve. Steve C's,
Steve.
Me doing Steve C's voice, people are captivated that I actually have to make movements.
You do.
Like Steve.
You have to.
To make it come out right.
I mean, Uncle Paul, too. You saw Uncle Paul.
The same. You saw his face. If you have not seen this video, it is Opie and Anthony's We Are the World.
And
it's on YouTube.
Should we play it for everybody?
Yes, yeah. Let's give this a play because obviously we drill things into the ground, and this is only part of that road to drilling this into the ground. Yes. Yay. Let's play We Are the World, the ONA and the ONA cast version.
The better version.
Of course, the best version.
Well, someone just walked in and see his cameo.
Exactly. It starts so sweet, doesn't it? With vocals by Mustard. There's a twilight. Hear the sun good.
Look at Opie and Anthony just laughing and smiling.
Yeah. Good video quality, though.
I like the beginning. Oh. We are the world, it says. And there we are in the studio, waiting for the vocals.
There comes a time when we hear
crows fly out of his beard.
He's good to hear, though.
Must stand together as one. There are people dying.
My favorite.
That's good.
Sam is doing the directing.
Yeah.
The greatest gift.
Some of the comments not too kind about me.
Really?
Yeah.
Haters.
We kick a wall. Pretending day by day.
Like the low shot of Kenny, which makes him look like the building he is.
No, this is what the cadaver looks up at the Undertaker and sees.
We are all part of. God's great big family.
That sweaty mess.
And the truth, you know, love is all we need.
Oh, Iraq.
We are the world.
Is that Iraq?
Oh, right.
His hat's on backwards. That's Tank.
Tank Hangaris. I bet he got good positive emails and texts, right?
Yeah.
Comments?
Yeah. There's a choice for me.
And that's the virus.
The virus.
Doesn't remember his punchlines or his line.
Why right me? Oh boy, huddla huddla. Oh, Patty with her angelic voice.
Send me a heart.
Her demonic face.
Oh. Someone called her the Susan Boyle of SiriusXM.
We can't let them suffer. No, we can't tell them the way to something. But right now they need a helping hand. Or foot. Or maybe shoulders.
Fat neck chip.
We are the children.
People walking by in the background.
Yeah, just trying to go to work.
Special moment. There's a choice we're making.
I got my coat on.
I am so out of there.
It's true. We'll make a gayer day, just you and
I love Ant in his fucking coat.
I had to get. I was leaving.
Well, you're done in that.
One take, I was done.
Doesn't seem so hope at all.
Oh.
But if you just believe, there's no way we could flow. Let us realize that a change can only come when we stand together as one.
Oh, I didn't even realize he actually sang.
Yeah, that's him. That's Opie.
We are children. We are the ones who make the world. So let's start by giving you a lift up.
There's a choice we're making. We're saving our own lives.
She's trying real hard.
It's true. We'll make a better day.
Her own timing.
Of course.
We are the world.
This is a disaster.
There's a choice
for me. We're saving our own lives. It's
true, like a better day. Kenny, look right into the camera.
It's a bunch of retards.
Roland just emoting.
Yeah.
I miss stupid Roland.
Uncle Fester.
He should have a light bulb in his mouth. Creep.
Come on now, let me hear you. We all the world.
Oh, yeah, Pat Fomenaki being hugged by Big A. A peace sign from Mustard. They'll be doing Ray Charles.
Uncle Paul, we're ruining their lives.
We're ruining their lives.
Is that what he said?
Yeah.
There's a lot of big dicks in the world. And none of them are in this room.
We are the world. Oh, no. We are the children.
Oh, God. Oh, Jesus.
Oh, they should have just filmed Anthony in the fucking elevator.
I really did run right out of there.
Great.
Wow.
Oh, that's nice. A little picture of Tippy Tom at the end.
Yes.
Nice job. Good job, Sam.
Tippy Tom. What a job. Again, amazing. Editing.
It's the players involved that deserve the applause.
Is it the magic you had to work with?
Yes.
Is how you were able to make the magic you created.
I mean, they make it easy for someone like me.
Yeah, yeah.
When Kenny sings We Make a Brighter Day, Just You and Me, I can picture him singing that to his Billy Club.
The way he points, though, to you and me, and he me. Pointed at the camera and then to himself.
Exactly.
Oh, he's so
looking right at the camera.
Look at him. What did you think of your performance there, Kenny, now that we've all seen it on video?
What did you think of it?
That's what I'm asking. What did you think of it? Get it? It's an anti-Semitic joke. What did you think? Did you like your part? I know you had a problem with the auto-tuning. You didn't want to be auto-tuned. You wanted people to hear your natural voice.
I know, but as it turns out, like usual, I was wrong.
See? Quincy Jones knew.
Yeah. He did. He texted me over the weekend and said he saw the video and he apologized. Yeah. Well, and said,
you should apologize.
I made him look very good, he said.
Yeah. What were people saying about you, Sam, that you said you got bad comments? You were there directing the people. How could they possibly say anything
bad? Wait,
about
wait. How come Steve and Danny weren't in it? And Travis?
I mean, they don't have character. We only did character. I didn't put myself in it either.
Okay, that's fair.
But you were the producer of the whole thing. They probably should have gotten in there and had to be part of the chorus at least.
Yeah, I guess so.
We are the world. I know I got a lot of flack for not doing a toodly-doo.
Yeah.
I said I was going to toodly-doo, but I was toodly-dooing right to my Escalade.
Yeah.
And getting the fuck out of here.
Yeah, it's the only one when he's singing, you hear traffic noise in the background.
but bang-up job. That was fantastical.
Yeah, it was better than I thought it was going to be.
Samuel. So if people want to see that, where can they go?
Opie and Anthony's We Are the World. Just search it on YouTube. It's right there.
Search it on YouTube.
The official video.
Everyone's so good at searching on YouTube.
No,
they always find everything. Yeah. Anytime someone tells me to find something on YouTube, I can never find it. And then I always get distracted and end up looking at hardcore pornography.
Well,
within two clicks, I'm fucking balls deep.
It's so much easier to find than anything else.
It really is.
I like to find on YouTube, though. You can't find good porn on
YouTube. No,
I'm
not
almost
on YouTube.
Glad you can't, because YouTube would be ruined by it. Porn would just be overrun with it.
No, but I go right to, like, oh, Red Tube. Okay, there's a tube in it, so I'm there.
X-Hamster.
Not bad either. I've gone there.
Danny is the connoisseur of online smut.
I used to tube-aid, I used to red tube, but now it's all about the X-Hamster.
X-Hamster's
good. They have everything.
I've heard very good things about X-Hamster. Intern David once told me that that's the website he likes to go to, and he also told me he sometimes jacks off to 3 times a day. So, obviously,
that was,
X-Hamster has got to be good.
then it has to be good.
Yes.
Do you miss X-Hamster?
Oh, every single day.
Yeah. No, he was great, wasn't he?
He was the best.
You said
ever.
His name. I had to try to remember who it was. That's how much
David,
I miss him.
Intern David ruled.
What?
He was great.
Certainly was.
He'll never be matched.
Why X-Hamster?
No.
Where do they?
I have no idea where they come up with the names for
is
these
it
things.
Is the letter X or just EX?
Like, no, after my rodent ran away, that's what I called it.
No, it's the letter X hamster. They just have a very, very good selection of things. It's updated, on the fly. So even if you beat off in the morning, if you go back later in the day for seconds, there's going to be all new videos up there. I have no affiliation with them. I have nothing to gain. It's just a nice site that I like to jerk off to.
There's one X-Hamster missing. Please return. Description: string tied to tail. Nose smells like duty.
Yes. Claws have been removed, and he'll have a frown on his face. Excellent burrower.
Maybe hiding in paper towel cardboard tube.
Maybe dressed as other animal to disguise himself. He used to put on porcupine costumes to deter me, but I knew it was him.
fucking Steve.
That X-Hamster one of the videos is simply called Old Fucker.
Old Fucker.
Which I think is literal.
And I guess that's what it is.
Yeah.
Do they have the usual suspects as far as subjects go?
Yes.
I like when you could go down the side and just go right to amateur.
Right up top. Alphabetical. So.
Do they have a blowjob cum shot? What about teen? That's always my faves. Do they have that? Some of them don't put it in.
Yes, teens.
All right.
Anything you can want. And even if you have your favorite porn star, you could just type her name in. And chances are there's going to be videos there. It's fantastic.
How do these sites actually survive doing free video? I'm astounded by that. It used to be you couldn't get a fucking thumbnail on a porn site without having a fess up cash. Or give, I'm sure, very reputable people your credit card. But now, you just pop on these sites, and you're getting jerk-off-addable video.
The ads. It's got to be the advertising.
But who's clicking the fucking ads?
I know people like us don't, but someone has to out
Mistakes?
There.
Mistakes?
Someone has to out there, or else these sites wouldn't exist.
You know what the only time I click on an ad is when they cleverly know you're rolling over something and just ready to click, and a pop-up pops up under your icon, and you click it.
A lot of times,
I fucking get so pissed at that.
A lot of these tube sites, they have like the pop-unders, where you don't realize that you have all this stuff coming up.
You shut the main page down, and there's 80 fucking pages behind it.
Fucking live cams or whatever it is.
Yes.
Yes. Click on those and I get a dollar.
I'm working on it as we speak.
Yes.
I mean, good for us because we like jerking off. But I don't even understand how, a startup porn company survives on the web these days. Ten years ago, I understand. But now, I don't think I've ever paid for pornography.
I have.
Never.
No. I've joined websites before.
Yeah?
Yeah, if I liked them.
God damn, there was just too much free shit. Sometimes you'd really have to hunt for it in the old school days of the 90s.
Well, I remember being on AOL. Wow. I had to be on like email lists, and you would go back and forth on like these big sign up to be on a mass mailing or something, and like that was the only way to get it.
You'd go into certain rooms that were trading GIFs, and you'd just sit there and wait, and then you'd hear,
"You've got mail."
Oh, I got mail, and now you click. And watch it scroll, and you're like...
Oh. It would be like Pavlov's dog. You'd hear that little, "You've got mail," and your dick would get hard.
Oh, and you realize some nice person sent it to the entire room. I remember how to do that.
I remember back in the IRC days, Internet Relay Chat for all you people out there, where you could actually... People would set up these file servers, sort of, when you could just kind of get into their computer. I mean, this is way before file sharing. It was kind of like, I guess, like the grandfather of file sharing.
Damn.
And you could just get into their, they would set whatever.
You were a cyberpunk.
I was a cyberpunk. And you could get into whatever folder they deemed public, and then you could just browse around and
take what you want.
Take what you want.
Get out.
Took forever to see, though. And then after a while of getting, like, going into those rooms on AOL, you'd gather up enough of a catalog where you could go into another room and be, like, a guy that
you could be the guy. Right.
And now you're getting stuff back. It was like a game. And then it would turn into,
you've got mail, you've got mail, you've got mail, you've got mail.
And you couldn't get enough porno. It was great.
It was great. I miss those days because now it's just so accessible. I think that you know,
the hunt is the hunt was great. It's because sometimes you get mail and you go, oh, this is good, this is good. It fucking picture sucks.
And
you'd
I remember
be all mad
when I first got AOL back in the day. You know, I didn't know anything about computers and I didn't realize that you could change the connection speed. You know, for the number that you were dialing into.
Oh,
so
yeah,
I had a my first computer had a 14.4 modem, but
rocking
for like the first year I was connecting at 2400 baud because I didn't realize that I could change the connection
to the
speed.
Lightning fast speed of 14.4.
So, I mean, just to get just to get like a 24K picture would take like 13 minutes, and I just remember being like a a kid sitting there just like pounding off, just fucking as it's coming in line by line.
Yeah. Fuck yeah, man!
Waiting, hoping that she had a really nice body or whatever.
And then you'd see her face and be like, all right, she's good, cute. This is good. This is good. Oh please! And then the tits are going cockeyed and fucks the whole thing up.
I mean, it was even more of a crapshoot on that IRC thing I was talking about, because it was all text-based, so you didn't even know what you were getting until you already had it.
Yeah, no thumbnails.
And then,
no
then you just have to open up, where you downloaded it to and just pray that you were going off a file name. So if a file name sounded interesting, like, well, I'll try to get that one.
And it's nothing. It sucks. You ever spank it to a thumbnail?
Yeah, probably.
That hurts.
My eyes are going crazy.
I've jerked off to Google Images. I mean, I could pretty much jerk off
Google
about
Images.
Anyway.
That's fucking hardcore. I don't even. Does anyone understand that? Like, do these groups that look into this shit and try to stop it understand you can get hardcore porno right there on the biggest search engine available to everybody?
And all you really have to do is come up with creative keywords to find exactly what you're looking for.
And just set your settings, though, because the automatic setting on thing is a moderate filter.
Yeah, safe search is usually moderate. Just take safe search off, type in your queries, and
queer.
Especially if you're gay.
I type in my queries. You ever realize that your safe settings were on?
Yes!
Sometimes it just comes on for no fucking reason, and you're looking for something, going, what the fuck? And then, my safe search is on.
It comes
off
when you reset your Safari.
Oh,
if you reset Safari, that resets your settings, or I imagine it's the same with Explorer.
Yeah.
Breaking news, by the way, news.
Yes.
Apparently, Vandersloot has admitted killing Natalie Holloway.
Did he?
Oh, yeah, that Dutch piece of shit apparently has admitted killing her on Dutch TV.
After all this time. And then he'll fucking pull the confession and... they knew he did it. Is he going to say where he put her and what
he did?
Do
not know. I just read on the ticker. They said Jordan Vandersloot.
Vandersloot.
Admits killing Natalie Holloway on Dutch TV.
Vandersloot.
Vandersloot. She was yodeling and not doing it right. I know I sound Caribbean.
I remember hearing years ago, though, that like someone had said that it was him.
And, oh, yeah.
And they took her out on a boat and just dumped her body in the water. So she ain't going to ever be found.
Well, her and the fucking the brothers, the Indian looking brothers.
Yeah.
I wonder if he why would he kill her? It's like, what for? What
people do? You watch these crime shows. I watch them all the time.
Did he rape her? You think? And then she was going to tell him.
Yeah,
maybe. Panic. Spoil fuck.
They do that all the time. Like, I can't understand. You watch these shows and go, how the fuck did you think you were ever getting away with that?
Right.
Ever! You left all kinds of shit, but then you look at something like OJ. I guess OJ is like their hope. OJ is like, hey, OJ did it. Maybe I'll get lucky. Roll the dice. Yeah.
I want to Google him. I want to make sure that that's right, but yeah, that's a big fucking...
Vandersloot! What a ghoul.
Yeah.
Vandersloot dad dies? What?
No, that's not.
No. Oh, look who's... I forgot because, Danny is behind the board.
Just
so
put
Sam
Natalie Holloway
on the internet.
Holloway.
Sam's the worst.
No, Sam doesn't know what
Sam's
he's doing.
Sam's the best at producing horrific versions of We Are the World.
He fucking put in Jordan. Michael Jordan's popping up. It's like wrong.
what are you doing? Michael Jordan killed her? What happened?
What are you looking at?
You stink.
Confession. Now, is this not true?
It's got to be true. Come on.
What's
Jimmy
happening?
Said it into a microphone.
I don't know. I'm reading. I'm sorry. That's what it said on the news. Apparently, he admitted it on Dutch TV. That's all.
Yeah, it's probably not, widespread yet.
How is it not? That's a big story.
Yeah, it's old hat now. They've moved on to other pretty white girls that
now
are missing.
It's a quote. Wait.
It says new confession, and confession's in quotation marks. What does that mean?
Chief suspect Joran van der Sloot now claims he dumped body of Alabama teen in Aruba Marsh. In a marsh.
Sounds like a name.
Yeah, Aruba Marsh. It's a great porno name. Aruba Marsh and Come in My Eyes.
10.
Yeah, Come in My Eyes 8 was no good. Really weak production.
Yes.
Yes.
Does the big guy have my salad?
Kenny?
Because, yeah.
I always, take a break.
I always say N-word has to eat.
Yeah.
I say it all the time at home, but I don't say N-word.
Nope, or
I
eat.
I do it with the A, or eat, right? And it's usually preceded by fucking. Yeah. No, I tease, of course. Everybody knows that.
So, is your salad here yet? Because we'll maybe, how about this?
Where my motherfucking salad?
We got Tom Papa coming like around 8, so.
Yeah, I know. I figured we'd break. Salad? We'll get my salad.
How is, don't tell me that dumbbell didn't get it yet.
Kenneth?
Tom Papa's here. He just arrived.
Okay.
That's why we're trying to time this out, right?
Yes.
We have one intern today, and he's currently at Starbucks, so I will go get Anthony's salad right now.
Oh.
So talk for 5 more minutes, and then your salad will be here.
5 minutes, my salad's here. All right, what's a good 5-minute topic of conversation?
Racism in America. Oh, I know what you're talking about.
I could, what, I thought an hour and 5 minutes? Or the rest of the show in 5 minutes?
Whale shows have resumed.
Ah, brilliant, James. Brilliant.
Whale shows have resumed.
Yeah.
3 days later.
3 days after the tragic death of one of the trainers down there at SeaWorld.
Yep.
By Tilly, or Tillicum.
Tillicum.
Or Till I Come. The killer whale. Aptly named,
Hubla, yes.
Hubla, dragged her down to the murky depths of her death in this huge tank. Played with her ponytail, I guess, is what they said. It's like a little fishing lure. And grabbed her ponytail with its little mouth and decided, I'm going to play. I don't understand the whole thing with lungs and water.
I think it understood.
You think?
Yeah.
Yeah?
Sure. They're very smart animals.
Fuck you and you're riding me around here like I'm some kind of boat.
It's a 6-ton animal.
Yeah.
It doesn't want to balance a ball for fucking fat people with mullets. They captured this thing. This was not born in captivity. They captured this thing.
They captured.
This was a captured whale.
Yeah. It's been in shenanigans before. It's been involved in 3 deaths.
Yep.
3 deaths. This thing, and yet it lives, because for some reason you can't euthanize a killer whale, or there's certain animals you don't euthanize after they kill people. Tigers, lions, fucking pit bulls, alligators, anything else, you shoot them. Remember that tiger that fucking got out and started eating those people at the zoo?
She killed one, injured two. I believe her name was Tatiana.
Oh, Tatiana.
I think so. Tatiana.
They didn't tranquilize Tatiana and then put it back in the cage and resume, you know, picture taking the next 3 days.
Right.
They killed the thing. What is it about, like, killer whales and other things? Is it that they're endangered? Or are they even endangered? I have no fucking clue.
They are endangered, except for the horrible Japanese who are continuing to fucking hunt them and sell whale meat. They're the fucking worst. Anything in the ocean, they just want to kill. Can they fucking cut the shit?
They love it. Do they hunt killer whale, though? I know they hunt the other blubbery whales.
Anything that's good in the water, they will massacre until it's the very last one gone.
You know why? They got these wacky ideas that if you fucking eat the meat from its dick or something, you'll get the wisdom of its past life or some shit. It's always something, shark fin. Very good shark fin. So they're just hacking fins off of fucking sharks.
I watched a documentary tonight. I didn't realize it was a documentary. It was called The Cove, about them still slaughtering dolphins. And
really?
I'm completely against it. I'm becoming a radical fucking animal.
You really are a red paint on the fur throwing
dude,
bitch.
I'm just tired of it. The fucking SeaWorld, the dolphin shows, just the way they capture dolphins.
They're so cute when they dance
lovely.
On their tail.
But the way they slaughter the ones that they don't use in Japan, there's a little cove where nobody can see. No one can see it. So this fucking team broke in. They set up hidden cameras. It was a whole fucking black ops operation.
Do they have canned laughs when things are happening? Like hidden camera, like candid camera. You just hear laughter as they're bashing him with machetes.
And Alan Funt is harpooning a smiling dolphin.
Google the cove. Dude, they kill so many dolphins. I've never seen this. The cove, it's an ocean cove, is red. It looks like they dumped Kool-Aid in the water.
Why would they kill them? Why not just let them go?
They sell the meat, which, by the way, is like is the highest thing of mercury in the world. It's very bad for you to eat dolphin meat because it's mercury poison.
It just doesn't seem like...
See Google Images. I want to see if they show any the blood in the fucking water. It's really terrible, man.
Where did you see this?
It's on a Time Warner.
Yeah, on demand?
Dude, it's
I'll check it out.
The guy who is Flipper's trainer...
For a few laughs.
Who trained Flipper?
Yes.
He feels responsible for a lot of it because he kind of started the dolphin craze by
people
with Flipper.
Love the dolphin. They call him Flipper. Flipper. Remember?
Yeah.
I remember that. Yeah, and everybody loves Flipper. But they kind of started the whole love affair with the dolphin. So gather them up, put them in tanks, make them balance balls on their fucking nose. Yes.
The way they fucking harpoon these things is fucking horrendous. And
really?
They just harpoon them, and the dolphins know what's happening because they're smart animals. It's fucking horrible, man.
Fish are one thing. They're just stupid. But like a dolphin, I guess, you kind of...
It's fucking...
They're intelligent little mammals.
They really are.
Look at these dopes wearing their SARS fucking masks.
And well, they're showing that the Japanese don't even know that this is happening. This is
really?
A small segment. Yeah, most Japanese.
So they told them, and they were like, "Oh, good."
They don't need dolphins.
Don't take photos. Signs.
Yeah. Those push them and get in your face. You're not allowed. They don't show the blood. They show the blood in the water. It's not. It's like I hate. It almost sounds poetic. The seas were red.
Yeah.
It literally looks like the whole cove is filled with Kool-Aid. I've never seen anything like that in my life. So fuck dolphin shows and fuck SeaWorld. SeaWorld stinks.
That's the hypocrisy, man, in our sick society. Like, we'll do business with horrid countries. With horrid countries.
Yep.
That we, as the United States, our citizens will protest us doing shit that isn't even close to what other countries are doing as far as pollution and animal abuse and stuff. But I know chickens and some cows get fucking pushed over by forklifts. I've seen the footage. It's terrible. But you know something? I like steak. I like chicken.
Yeah.
Dolphin, that's another thing. But we'll do business with Japan.
Sure.
And fucking our presidents go over there and kiss their ass. We go over to China and kiss their fucking ass. And meanwhile, their human rights violations
horrible.
Are just abominable. One of the worst, probably the worst in the world as far as having so many people so oppressed and so being tortured and working for nothing. And I love how we get, or not we, but companies will get blamed for using their labor. But meanwhile, it's perfectly fine in their country. So, you know, I guess Apple was getting some shit for using child labor on their iPods and iPhones and shit. We're getting in a little Dutch.
Ah.
But you know something? If it's readily available and cheap, people are going to do it. I'm not saying it's right. It takes away jobs from the U.S. But you know something? Then boycott the whole fucking country. Don't let them make our products. Don't buy their shit. Let them go broke and or step up and have rights for their workers and stop polluting the environment and stop killing fucking dolphins. But you know something? It's too hard to do.
You know what, dude? You got your dolphins, you got your whales. You know what, dude? They know better. They just don't swim when they're going to get caught, dude.
And then you'd bring up stuff. You know what they did in World War II? They put mines on their heads and they swam into ships, dude. Because it's something he read about 20 times separated from the fact.
No, he saw it in an Aquaman comic. That's how Bob gets half his knowledge. He fucking reads Aquaman.
Dude, Aquaman!
What, dude? They can surf in the sky, dude!
He's a fucking blithering idiot. A boob, as I like to say.
So, yeah, they've resumed whale shows at fucking... I love... And I had money against that trainer. I'm sure she loved animals. I'm sure she did. But, you know, I love
she
when...
She died the way she wanted to. Drowning horrifically.
Yeah, exactly. Being pulled by her fucking
giant
scalp.
Beast.
By a 12... fucking 6-ton monster.
It's a monster.
Scraping the bottom of a fucking 40-degree fish tank.
Realizing, oh, shit, I really need to inhale.
Well, onlookers peaked. What a horrible death.
Oh, gotta be. Just that moment where you go, you know something? I gotta breathe in. I don't care what the fuck is out there. I cannot stop. My body is telling me to inhale. Oops, it's water. I'm dead.
Yeah, I think that the whales knew better. I think that the whales aren't stupid. You know, they know what they're doing.
Yeah.
Yeah, those fucking criminal whales.
It's horrible. So they're doing it just days after. People will be in the stands waving their little Shamu flags and holding their little Shamu stuffed animals and watching Shamu, which is like five different whales. They just call them, and ladies and gentlemen, let's bring out Shamu! Oh, is that the one that killed the woman? Or is that the one that fucking the guy was killed by three of the whales? Is that him? Or is that the one that was being fucked in its blowhole by the guy and dragged underneath by his dick?
These are things that fucking, that kill sharks. The nerve of people to think they can put on a wetsuit and make this thing fucking balance a ball for a salmon.
Yeah, they just keep throwing fish in its big, ugly mouth.
Yeah, it's like, that's what, they can do that on their own. They don't need you.
Yeah. Yeah, they figured out how to eat.
How annoyed would you be as a person if some pussy life form was feeding you for tricks?
Yeah, making you do tricks. You know something, though? I would really love that if some superior alien race that just looked at us like fucking parasites would come down here and just make us hungry and then feed us little treats to just entertain them in circuses.
Imagine if it was kittens. A fucking life form we know we could kick the shit out of if we got our hands on them. Imagine if kittens fucking were ruling our lives and making us do tricks. Spin in a circle and sing that Beatles song and I'll throw you a fucking chipwich.
And then you get a burrito.
While other kittens are clapping you like, hey, fuckers.
You barely hear it. Thoop, thoop, thoop. Soft little paws of theirs.
Little non-fucking offensive
little
hands.
They're adorable kittens. Let's take a little break.
Yeah, we got, we're going to eat something and then we have Tom coming in a few moments.
Tom? Yeah.
You're out, Tom.
We'll talk about the new show. The Marriage Ref. How was Seinfeld involved in that?
He's the exec producer and probably the co-creator.
Oh,
your stuff is here.
Coffee was that? I'll see my fucking salad, bitch.
He's on the air, too.
I'll see my salad.
Oh, Jerry's in the first show, I know.
He was last night, and I think he pops up again later in the season because he was in the preview.
Okay.
Yeah, boy, they can't show him enough in that preview.
Sure.
They got a lot of big stars, and they have Ricky Gervais and Madonna. Yes.
Madonna's on next week.
Madonna, how do you call and get a Madonna?
Yes, I'm booking for the show.
Yes.
Would you guys like Madonna and Ricky Gervais and Seinfeld?
I got the wrong Madge. I got the one whose hands were in Parmalov.
Wow, you're going back. That's great.
I'm soaking in it. Come.
We never leave him alone. All right, we'll return
back
after
shortly.
Short break. Some rock and bets coming back in. Damn. Right?
Let's put some full songs in, though. I don't want beds.
No. Eat beds.
What is this?
See, you can't. This is Low by Foo Fighters.
Oh.
Good running.
But we'll never, hear a vocal or anything, right? Of course not.
Tom Papa has come in, and I have to ask Tom to move his hat. Because I've never wanted to put my fist through anything as bad as Tom's fedora.
You could always go to Shea 45 and have somebody come over here and remove it
for
him.
Yeah, I'm sure they would be happy to do that.
Well, Jimmy, you're always attacking my hat.
I can't not. Tom is a man meant for good clothing.
Yeah.
This is what a fucking pussy whip guy I am. I went to buy this long black jacket that I have.
I noticed you're very sporty in it.
He is sporty.
Yeah.
But Papa is a good dresser. And I'm with my girlfriend and I'm like, I got to get it. And Tom, I'm like, Tom, how long should my jacket be? And he goes, well, it should come a little below the waist and above the knee.
See, he knows.
Anything longer and just looks stupid. And the one I got was like below my fucking knee. And I'm like, he's going to humiliate me when I see him.
Stupid.
Yeah, Tom is not going to approve of my jacket.
But you actually gave me a tip. You had gone to Macy's.
Yes.
And you told me where the coats were, and I went the next day and bought this.
Oh, wow. That is kind of similar almost.
Yeah.
A little bit.
I dress like
that?
Jimmy.
A pea coat? Is that a pea coat?
It's just a long black coat.
How long is it?
It's the right length.
The right length above the knee?
Yeah.
All right, the man's
When length. I went in, I hadn't been to Macy's in such a long time, and I'm in there, and I'm confused and bumbling around, and I banged into this group of black kids. They were like probably, I don't know, 18. It's like three girls and two guys, and I just kind of like bumbling old man just kind of like banged into them, and the girl goes, watch it, tidy whitey.
And how great is that?
And whitey.
And I'd never heard that before, and it was like 5 minutes later, I was like, oh, she was talking about me.
Yes.
I call that the T word. I don't like being called that at all.
Tidy Whitey. It was great and awful at the same time.
Like, what is I guess, why the tidy part?
I guess because I'm uptight.
Uptight
white guy.
Oh, all right, I get it. And it's kind of like underwear, too.
It's underwear, the tidy whitey.
What a great racial insult has a hyphen in it.
Yeah.
You have to love any insult with a fucking hyphen.
Oh, that's good.
Had you ever heard that one?
No, I can't wait to be called that. Tidy Whitey.
You watch it, Tidy Whitey. I was like, I wonder who she's... Oh, it's talking about
I'm
me.
Tidy Whitey. Oh, I get it.
It's me, the successful white guy.
I'm looking for a jacket like Heinrich Himmler. I like those long leather ones. Those are out of fashion, though.
No.
You can't really go for the real long, because those are below the knee.
But those are always in because very few people wear them, so you're just that badass guy with that coat.
That coat is so good. The fucking Nazi leather was the best.
Cinched at the waist.
Oh, the big lapels and shit.
Broad shoulders.
Oh, just the meaning behind the whole thing.
Even if people don't know the meaning, they just don't even want to ask.
The best dressed bunch of genocidal motherfuckers on the face of the earth. Look at that jacket.
They did have nice coats. But I have to say, it's hard to forgive what they did because they had snappy coats.
You know, their clothes were very attractive.
Yeah. Idi Amin was a prick, but he had great shoes. All right, well, way to take lemons.
I know they're bad, but man, they looked hot.
They just looked great. Hey, you know what? That is why also in movies and stuff, you will always see kind of the bad guy in the kind of Nazi attire. Because it's just there's this cool evilness to that look.
It is so, it's completely badass.
Yeah, like Star Wars was very, you know, like Nazi.
Star Wars?
The original one, when they're on the Death Star and Vader comes over and Vader's minions and everything.
It's
very like Nazi.
Vader's
and
a Nazi.
Yeah, Vader's like a fucking Nazi. Even his helmet was that Nazi.
That's right.
Kind of shaped helmet and everything like that. He looked like a cyber Nazi.
All that was missing was that little spike on the top.
Yeah.
That is a dead giveaway.
Vader.
No nice hat has ever had a fucking metal spike on it.
Nice fedora with a spike and nothing. Yeah, derby, a bowler hat.
And yet the mustache didn't catch on.
No, that is gone for good.
Gone for good.
That man destroyed it. You know, that was a very popular stash in like the 20s, I guess.
Yeah.
Chaplin had it. A lot of, if you look at, especially the Germans in World War I, a lot of them were sporting that stash. And boy, that just stopped it. You cannot walk down the street with that mustache.
You're not going in into the barbershop and saying, just take it off on the sides.
Yeah, just the sides. Leave the middle, and I'm going to go shop for a real long leather.
And a spiky hat.
You just look ridiculous with the if you had a Hitler mustache, people would go, what the fuck are you doing? You just look stupid. Terrible mustache.
People still do like the waxed fucking
the handlebar
from 1880.
Mustache. A pugilist.
Yeah. Put up your, what is it, Marcus of Queensbury rules or something?
Get me my one-piece bathing suit.
Yes.
My one-piece male bathing suit.
I'm going to lift the big dumbbells at the beach. that's still a viable mustache. It looks silly, but people walk around with it.
Yeah.
The Hitler mustache, you will just be crucified.
I know it's Zell. Zell. And by the way, one of the guys in that scene, the marathon man, bit of trivia, was the time to make the donuts guy.
Dunkin' Donuts.
He was the guy.
Was he the diamond guy?
Yes, he's the guy standing with him.
See, Blade's got him.
Yeah, Blade at the same thing. Nazi coat.
They were just showing Blade. I guess,
Wesley Snipes is promoting
Wesley Snipes
shit.
Is on channel. He's promoting, hey, you're fucking tacky.
Yeah, he's promoting, I need dough. Yeah.
April's coming up. Help me out.
He's trying to make April 15th a national holiday.
Please send money, Tidy Whitey.
He looks fucking great.
Remember me, Tidy Whitey?
Yeah. I entertained your ass, and now Uncle Sam's after me. Help me out.
He looks great. Except he's wearing the same necklace that fell by Greg Brady in that fucking Hawaiian episode.
Don't go surfing, Denzel. Yeah. You'll wipe out.
Was that Tiki? No, it was...
The Tiki.
And that fucking homoerotic Hawaiian friend Greg made.
Caused a lot of troubles on their vacation.
It really did, right? apparently something bad happened to Mr. Brady. I'm not sure what that was.
He must have gotten the tiki a little too long, or he put it somewhere he shouldn't have.
Tickled his tiki.
And I admitted, by the way, that I missed Tom's show last night. I'm kind of annoyed at myself because I did plan on seeing it. I normally don't watch my friends on TV.
I don't know. Just to get through the closing ceremonies to get to my show was a bear.
Yeah, quite a challenge.
I'm there.
I'm a big Avril Lavigne fan, I gotta tell you.
Giant beavers running across the stage. The Canadians are not good at show business.
No, they stink. Terrible at it.
A weird butterfly and fat girl in the butterfly wings.
Yeah, they stink.
That? A lot of native, I was going to say Native American, Native Canadian dance and stuff.
Yeah, and the like Mountie. That. Do you need to see one more Mountie in your life?
You know something? If Canada wants to stop with the stereotype, stop with the Mountie.
Yeah.
That is like, we made a cartoon that made fun of your Mounties.
We're cool, eh? We're cool. Yeah. No, you're not. You're wearing a Mountie uniform.
A Canadian Mountie. Just think about that. We look goofed on them with fucking...
Dudley Do-Right.
Like, I think they had like cartoons of just cops beating the fuck out of black people here, and that was their fun cartoon of America.
Yeah. They're hilarious.
Yeah, that's funny.
The Olympics should end.
Hysterical.
The Olympics should end like movies in the '40s. Like after the last event, just go and have the end scroll past, and it's done.
I know.
They really didn't give a shit who made it.
Catherine O'Hara coming out and trying to do stand up in front of a stadium, and Neil Young all shaky with his little guitar.
Wait, who's Catherine O'Hara?
She's a Canadian.
She's a comedian?
She's like a Second City. Oh, okay. She does all those Christopher Guest movies. She's great.
Was she funny?
Really fun, but no.
In that atmosphere, how are you going to be
funny?
How
can you be funny?
What did she say?
She just came out and was doing bits and, Canadians and, sorry, there wasn't a lot of snow, but now you know that we're not just one giant piece of tundra. And they applaud. More than that.
You know, they want to be so much more.
No, you're not even that.
Big block of ice. Meanwhile, 90% of the population's 10 miles from our border.
Right, exactly.
And the rest, why don't they live in the rest? Because it's a frozen tundra.
Right, exactly. Come useless. On. Useless.
You got the most useless real estate ever. It's ice.
Shatner went on.
I did see that. I was at the cellar when that happened. Yeah. Is he Canadian? Shatner. I didn't know he was Canadian.
I didn't either. Yeah, he is.
Yeah, you talked about that when he was here. I call him Bill Shatner.
Oh, really? You're tight?
Good friends with him. Yeah.
Really?
Pretty tight. Let me tell you what he loves.
My HBO special.
Enjoy that. He loves when he's trying to talk about his new interview show or anything he's ever done during his career. And I playfully chime in and try to equate it to every Star Trek episode I've watched 1,000 times. You will never see a man more annoyed than when I bring up the Gorn or the gangsters of Triskelion when he's trying to talk about his interview with Meatloaf and how in depth it was and how he got emotion out of it. I'm like, emotion, like the emotionless aliens of Rigel 7 when you were out. He gets so pissed.
Does he really?
And I love it.
Oh, that's
awesome.
He almost
flipped his wig. what are you going to do?
By the way, can I tell you how stupid E-Rock is? Can E-Rock come in here?
We only have another couple of hours here on the show.
Because Tom was out there and Eric was like had a fun fact about Tom Pompa.
Oh, wow. All right. Here comes E-Rock. Wow, he's running.
Oh,
I hope his momentum can stop before he barrels through the window.
I hope he runs right through the studio and out the other window. Plummets to his fat death.
He's like that momentum guy in X-Men. Just keeps going through walls.
I know something.
He's the Juggernaut. That's it. He's the Juggernaut.
The Juggernaut.
Emphasis on not.
Okay, now what were you saying about Tom? Because you had a fun fact.
What's up, E-Rock?
I asked Jimmy a question about Tom Papa. Make sure. He's like, I don't know too much about that. Make sure you ask him.
Why
don't
you tell
him
the question you asked me? That was the point.
What are you doing?
He's winded.
He ran 20 feet.
No. It's almost like if I said, hey, what was that joke? And he goes, he said some stuff and it had a punchline.
Yeah.
It's like, well, you're missing the interesting part.
Come on. Look at him breathing.
Okay.
You ran.
What I asked,
you didn't even run as far as Steve drove Friday. Just relax.
What I asked Jimmy was, I was saying, didn't he do a talk show over in Europe for a while?
And I didn't realize I had him confused with somebody else.
Now, I knew that Tom had never done a talk show over in Europe. Yes. So I told Stupid, I'm like, you got to come in and ask him about that.
And when Jimmy said that, of course, the Jimmy light went off.
Yeah, I'm like, I can't ask him because I know him.
There's no way there's a legitimate reason why I should be asking him a question.
Other than
I'm like, it's Tom somebody. And I went and did a search, and it was Tom Rhodes. And I had him confused with Tom Poppin. And then I looked at Jimmy and go, I realize my mistake. I'm sorry, and Jimmy's just standing there laughing.
I really wish.
I love how winded he is, and he didn't even run. He just got like the hop, like when a car comes and you just want to get through the crosswalk, just a little hop run. He's completely.
All right, so
yeah, I'm fine.
He's trying not to swallow because if he's talking like this, because if he swallows, he's gonna go.
You know what, E-Rock? The sad thing is, the only reason we know that is we've been there.
Yeah,
see,
it's true.
See, there, but for the grace of God, go a big fat fuck.
And you weren't that. And you weren't that. You weren't that far off. There was a guy named Tom that had a talk show in Europe.
Yeah, good point.
So
yeah.
It's not that far off.
So we're here with Tom Snyder. Yeah. Loved your talk show back in the 70s.
Were you mad when Rosie O'Donnell asked you about being an NRA member? Tom Selleck, for anybody under the age of 30.
Tom Selleck. So we should absolutely talk about the pogrom.
Yeah.
So, now what? What's the gist of this? Give me a little synopsis.
The Marriage Ref is a comedy panel show, but that's based in marriage. So we have three celebrity guests that come on. I host it, and we show little snippets of real couples, and we give them something that married couples never get, which is a declared winner, an end to their bullshit fights that go on forever.
Yeah, because every married couple, there are bullshit fights.
And they go on forever.
Yeah. And they're meaningless.
And you can't win because you're both in it.
Yeah.
So I come in, and I just, right or wrong, I end it.
Is it now like almost a jury listening to their testimony, and the celebrities kind of add in there?
The celebrity's job is to convince me of which way they think I should go. So they say that I should go for the husband or the wife and why, and it's but it's up to me. I have the ultimate say.
Now I saw Alec Baldwin at one point.
Yeah, he was hilarious.
Now something tells me there's a little bias going on as far as who should be right, the man or the woman. I think regardless of what happens, he probably thought the man was right.
I'm finding out that people that have been through marriage and come out the other side are the best guests. Because there is a real rage that you can tap into. Larry David was on last week.
Ooh.
Excuse me.
Larry David had been through the mill?
Oh, yeah.
I didn't.
Yeah.
Oh, didn't he just get divorced? He's married to an environmentalist or something, like a real...
Oh, God. Did he just get divorced?
He must have, right?
Like a year?
Oh, shit.
A year ago?
All that fucking Seinfeld money.
Curb money.
DVD money. Oh, son of a bitch. For what? What did she do for it?
She hung out.
I'm sure she wrote the whole thing with the soup Nazi.
Worked on some charities.
Worked on some charities.
Took a cooking class.
You know, you wouldn't look good when you went on these appearances if it wasn't for me dressing you.
Really?
Would I not have?
But you get guys like that on the show, and they just, you could just see it starting to bubble and come to the surface.
Punch the bitch.
Marriage is stupid.
Yeah, it's a useless institution.
But what's really cool about it, I mean, it's, I don't know how to describe it because it's kind of a new show in a way. It's not in the middle of hosting it. Sometimes I feel like I'm in a talk show.
Mm-hmm.
And then sometimes you feel like reality, but you're only showing like 2 minute clips of these people. And then, you know what I mean? So it's kind of, well, the coolest part is it's what you always wanted the Tonight Show to be, where you have celebrities that aren't prepared. They're not plugging anything and they're just riffing with each other.
Right.
That's the best part.
It's like old school Tonight Show.
Yeah, they just
like
go.
Like Dean and shit. Dino would just come in with a drink, sit down, start bullshitting with Johnny.
That's the best part.
And then go, I gotta go. And he would just leave.
With a cigarette dangling out of his
mouth. Tonight Show, you asshole. There's an author in the back all pissed. Right. Now he's bumped.
Exactly. That's the best. Dave, and it hasn't been that for so long. Because everyone comes on Tonight Show and they're plugging something. They got a book and they have a pre-interview and all this stuff. We had Madonna, Larry David, and Ricky Gervais on. They're going to be on soon.
Do you realize on that episode, you have better guests than we've ever had on this show?
Ever.
That is by far a bigger guest list.
God.
Crazy. Jeez. We can go nowhere but down.
That's right, exactly.
We're going. How about, I kept saying, let's. Why don't we spread them out? one on each show. Right.
Yeah, we'll have Madonna and that guy from the WB show, and then somebody else. But that's the beauty of Seinfeld being involved, is they all know and respect him. So it's like, you know, on his.
Yeah,
they're just making a phone call.
It's different Seinfeld calling or, let's say, Steve Carlisi calling.
Hello, Madonna.
Not going to have the same thing as I. It's Jerry on the phone for Madonna.
I can't believe you're even in your scenario. He's talking to Madonna.
Yeah, exactly.
No, he's not, though. No. He thinks it is because somebody's doing a poor Madonna impression. And then he'll come running and saying, I have Madonna.
No, he's actually in the phone book under M. I think she's unlisted.
I tried. Back to my website.
And Tom, you've been working with Jerry for a long time. This is what I like about Seinfeld. I don't know him well. I've known him probably 6 or 7 years very casually. I don't know him well. Mm-hmm. But he is probably the most honest guy in show business. You will never not know exactly where you stand at any given moment.
From the stories I've heard.
There's nothing phony about him.
Nothing. Even working, I mean, I've been friends with him for a long time. We've been on the road together for a long time. We've become really tight. But once you get into the scenario of making the show, I mean, he's not just executive producer, you don't see him. He's working every day on it.
Yeah.
And he rides me about making sure every word is perfect. You know, I have some, and if you screw up a joke, there's nothing worse.
Because
he doesn't fake laugh. He doesn't that's cool, try it again. He just, that's not the joke!
No.
It's brutal. It's hard.
And you get nervous.
Yeah, exactly.
And you don't want to feel like your buddy who has put, obviously you're a very funny dude and he puts all this faith in you. And you don't want to go, oh my God, I'm letting him down. Oh my God, he's going to think he made the wrong decision.
Exactly. You know, he's really put himself out there to make me the host of the show.
Yep.
And you don't want to let him down. And, you know, I'm me. I'm going to let him down at some point.
That is the definitive comic right there.
Right.
I will disappoint.
Yes. Right. I'm going to do my best, but boy, I'm going to screw up.
I'm going to fail miserably.
The question, Jerry, is on what level will I fail you?
Yeah, right.
Is it going to be never speak to me again or a couple of years? What are we working on here? Well, what kind of problems, as far as the marriages go, like, have you been solving? Obviously not, I killed your mother. The kind of problem.
Yeah.
She was quite a bitch.
Well, you know, we go through a ton of casting footage of these real people that want to be on the show, and every once in a while you get one where there is just an anger there, where you're like, no, these people are really ready to blow. If I side with the husband, cameras go off, and it's a right hook.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
You're getting it.
Yeah, so you want to keep it light. If these are people, this isn't whether I'm going to leave marriage or stay in marriage. This is just, we're staying in it, but...
Yeah, we got an issue.
Yeah, but my husband keeps his Harley in the living room, and I want it out. Stuff like that.
Right, right.
You know what I mean?
Things that can be resolved by
Harley's
a ref.
A hooker that works out. That was probably a bigger problem than it sounded when you said it.
Right. She won't get off the couch.
And Porsche's in the bed.
There's certain things you don't want the marriage ref deciding, like, I think my wife's having an affair with the janitor. It's a tall Dominican fellow.
And I'm just getting some laughs. And I think you should keep going.
Yeah, I bet she's a size queen. I think you read about them in the paper. Yeah, I guess you want to keep it kind of, you know, to a certain level of...
Yeah.
How was Madonna? Because, you know, she just went through a divorce. I mean, she's going through one.
Yeah, she doesn't come across as somebody that seems like she would have a sense of humor now.
Yeah, right. I mean, did you see her last Letterman? You know, she goes on Letterman and she will get, like, stone cold. And it's just, she's just having fun, but it's just kind of, he's trying to pull it out of her.
Yeah,
yeah. It's just a hard interview and... I was thinking this could be great or it could be a nightmare. And she came out, I met her backstage, and she was just fun. She was just like riffing and ballsy. And I was like, oh, if this comes on the stage, this will kick ass. And she got out there and was just throwing fastballs, getting in Larry David's face. You hate women, giving him the finger.
Wow, great.
She was awesome. She was so
holy shit
awesome. I was like, this is the coolest. I mean, first of all, growing up in the 80s.
Yeah.
And then, you know, Madonna was just all... And now she's, like, right here.
Yeah.
And thinking, you know, of course she's going to be hot and that kind of thing. But then for her to be funny like a comic, just blew me away. Then I was just like, I'm in love all over again.
Wow, and Gervais.
Surprising.
And yeah. Gervais on the same panel, who I think is the funniest guy fucking alive. Gervais is fantastic.
He's like annoying funny.
Yeah, you're like, all right, die.
Right, exactly.
Brilliant in everything.
I know. We get it. Can you suck at one thing, please?
Just a naturally funny dude, man. It's rare to see a guy that absolutely funny all the time.
Stops his shows like years before he should have.
Yeah.
What an asshole.
No, I'm just done creatively. Yeah. I think I'm done.
I want to move on to something else successful.
And most things I've done have peaked and fucking withered in the pilot.
I know, exactly. That's what I was thinking last night when it aired. I was like, well, that was a good run.
Yeah, that was good. Resume stuffer.
Right.
There we go.
When you watched it, I mean, who was on last night's episode?
It was Alec Baldwin, Seinfeld, and Kelly Ripa.
Okay, that's great.
Yeah. And then Thursday... Our regular slot is going to be Thursdays at 10 after 30 Rock.
Jesus.
And it's going to be Thursday's going to be Tina Fey, Eva Longoria Parker, and Seinfeld again.
Wow. Okay, so Seinfeld's not just doing a one-off. That's great.
He's going to do, like, we're doing 9 for this season, and he's going to do 2 of them.
That's great.
Or 3 of them. 3 of them.
Now, how do you know these people are going to stick to the decision that was made?
You don't.
Thank you. You know what? If here it is, the guy wins, he doesn't win. He goes home, woman, same thing. The girl wins.
Yes.
Because she will bring it up every time,
right.
And the guy will be crushed and be, oh, okay.
I think that's what it gives you more than anything, is just, well, all of America thinks you're wrong.
Yeah.
I'm right. All of America says so. At least it gives you a little something to it.
It's good because, like, you know, you'll get married people watching going, yes, you're an asshole.
Right.
They'll sit there and watch and go, see?
Yeah.
And you do that. Shut up.
Yeah, you do that. Or, I mean, there's nothing better when you're walking down the street here in the city and you see a couple going at it.
Oh!
Because it's not you.
I don't care if I'm late for anything. Right. And enjoy the show.
Yeah. It's just like, that guy's going through some shit and I don't have to, and I've been there, but for once it's not me.
Yeah.
That's what this show kind of gives you.
I saw one outside of, like, right by Fifth Avenue, where a woman's, and the guy is just carrying bags and bags, and she's like, you promised to me that you were going to do this for me and give me a whole day, and you have to go. And I stopped, and I'm watching, and he's like, we've been shopping, look what I got in my hands, and she wanted the whole fucking day.
Right.
The whole day.
I hate that one. You were going to give me the whole day.
And it was great.
But
and
you feel great.
I felt like, that's not me.
Yeah.
Fuck her.
Watch it be something important, though, like he promised to get her cancer medication, but forgot. Like, she's actually right. He's just a piece
he's
of shit.
Just an asshole.
You're rooting for him.
Yeah. Go get her. Yeah, fuck her.
You get tapes from people. I imagine the one downfall, but you're going to get certain tapes where you know that they're playing it up just to get on TV.
Yeah.
So you probably have to weed through that to, like, legitimately. Yeah, that isn't, like, a real problem to have.
Yeah, we almost got fooled right off the bat.
Oh, really?
There was a couple that was... He had something where he was choking on his... He'd like to take all his vitamins at once. He would take like 20 vitamins and he would just hack. And it was hilarious. We're watching. You're like, this guy's hilarious. Leave me alone. I'm taking it. Ah! He's like, we're great for the show. And then somebody in the company went online and looked them up. They had a whole website of how to get on reality shows, how to fake your things, how to get on Survivor, how to get on this one, how to get on that one.
At least you check.
Yeah.
You know, some people that don't even check and wind up getting bamboozled every time.
You know what we're losing a lot is people fail their psych test. I didn't realize everyone who tries to get on these shows, they have to go through a psych test.
Jesus. Oh, probably because the lawyers have determined that if something happens and then they leave the show and the husband bashes in the wife's head with a fucking ball-peen hammer,
right.
You will be held liable.
Or shows up at the studio and takes a shot at the marriage ref. With an Uzi. They're like, well, he passed the psych test. We're not responsible.
Yeah. Wow. Okay, a psych test.
Yeah, and a lot of people fail it. You're like, oh, this woman's crazy. This is great. And then, she didn't pass the test.
Do you like that, or do you think it's a little too much?
What, the psych test part?
Yeah.
I don't know. You know,
that's something obviously lawyers came up with.
Obviously,
we all know.
I'll tell you.
Now we all know how funny lawyers are.
Hilarious.
They are like the cornerstone of comedy.
Oh, I disagree.
And good souls.
Oh, literal gems.
Oh, I don't think that's true, guys.
Oh, stop it. When they get their little fucking mitts in there.
I know, because we had, for this, we're taping on Wednesday. And we tape here in the city, by the way, if any of your people want to come.
New York City?
New York City.
Where do you tape? Which is at Rock, 30 Rock.
CBS Broadcast Center on 57, Jimmy.
I was completely wrong.
You went with NBC.
Hey, well, it's an NBC show.
It's an NBC show, but,
you know, they tape somewhere else.
Well, I didn't realize that CBS would whore its own studios.
Oh, my God.
But we were taping.
Don't air the show on CBS just for some money.
Yeah, exactly.
Whores.
Yeah, anything you got. What do you got? But we were going to tape. We're taping on Wednesday, and we had two of the couples ready to go, and they failed their psych test last minute, and we had to take them out. And I'm like, they're hilarious. Who cares if they're going to.
What is the psych test?
Kill themselves after. Yeah, this is good TV. We need TV.
Do you hear how they fail the psych test? Do you get a little intro?
You know, they know, but they're hesitant to tell us. Because we keep asking. We're like, well, why? And well, it's just done nothing.
Why don't you film? Here's what you ought to do. Film the psych test, and people sign off on it, and then show, these are some people we were going to have, and then show them breaking down or failing their psych test. How great would that be?
That could be a whole spinoff show just called Psych Test.
Yeah.
I wonder how many shows do that. Is that kind of common practice?
It's common practice. All these reality-based shows.
I can only. You know what? There was a murder after Jenny Jones.
Yeah.
That's probably a piece of it.
Was that the gay one?
Yeah.
A guy.
Did he kill himself?
A guy was gay. And he came out on stage and talked to a straight guy about what a crush he had on him.
Right.
And the straight guy wound up killing the gay guy.
Right. Oh boy.
Problem? Yeah.
Psych test.
Psych test.
I think we should maybe give a psych test.
A lawyer right then and there, when he read that in the paper, was like, all right, let's get right to the psych test thing so I can start making some money.
I got a new business.
Yeah.
Psych test R Us.
Psych test for fucking reality shows. That's weird because it kind of takes the reality out of some reality shows. This, it could work because people are still married and still have their problems and everything.
Yeah.
But I mean, some things you want fucking lunatics.
Well, what's weird is that there are some guys that are complete lunatics that have been on the show and like, well, he passed the psych test. And then these other people that seem normal, they're like, no, that dude's trouble.
Yeah.
Well,
it's weird. Like, you can't, you know, you don't know. Like, just look around the studio.
Well, around the studio, we know. We've worked here long enough to know. We've had our own psych test personally, just talking to these animals.
Yeah.
We realize, hello, yes.
Yeah.
There you're talking to a guy that probably will bust in with a machine gun.
This is a weird day for me because I am doing your show to start the day, and then at 4 o'clock or whenever it is, I'll be on Oprah.
Oprah?
How about that?
It really is a big drop off after the morning radio show. Yeah. Well, luck. I guess you got to do Oprah.
But I'm a lot more comfortable right now.
I imagine so.
Yeah.
Oprah. Now, what do you?
We taped it last week.
How'd it go?
It was good, but you know, it's a little bit of a head trip.
Is it like, were you intimidated?
A little bit. Not until I'm like, oh, who cares? It's just a show, you know? And then she walks up.
You try to tell yourself that. Isn't that funny when you try to say, it's just a show?
Yeah, or you have guests and you're like, oh, it's just a guy. It's just a guy just like me. Oh my God, he's right here.
it's just a show. My stomach hurts.
Right? Yeah. Why am I yawning uncontrollably?
Yeah. Isn't that horrible?
Yeah.
Hey, I'm here to promote Navigant's Oprah.
Exactly. And she came in the green room to say hello to Jerry first, and she's hugging and kissing him because she knows him so well. And then she goes to say hello to me, and she shakes my hand, and I go in for the kiss.
No!
And I'm going to...
Oh, shit.
It's too late. I'm going for the kiss, and she's pulling my hand down like we don't know each other that well yet.
Oh!
But it's too late, so I go and complete the kiss, and it felt so awkward.
I am douche-chilling.
I can't look at Tom.
I know.
I can't look at Tom.
I know exactly what you're talking about, and it's... A horrible feeling.
She's kind of strong and just pulled my hand down like, no, we don't have to do the kiss part. We don't.
At that point, just try to go for tongue.
Yeah, you have to
just to say that you gave her tongue.
Fucking, poor Oprah. She's trying to do the right thing and Tom's giant head is leaning in towards her.
Coming in with my hat on.
Yeah. Out with her.
Jerry, there's a Macy's float coming in, attacking me. But it's like, you don't know what to do. You want to give her a kiss.
I figured she's so warm and loving and so.
Not
of course you kiss. Not yet.
Oh, yeah. Maybe a couple of more meetings.
Yeah. But then after the show, It went fine. It went great. And she comes up to me after the show and just grabs my head in her hands and says something like, "Welcome to my living room. It's so nice to have you. Jerry's right. Welcome to my living room." And then pulled me in for a big boob hug.
That's great. Wow. All right. That's good.
Then all I was right, like, that's nice. All right. Then of course, the hoary part of me was like, "That's great, but why didn't you do that on air?" everyone would have been, "Oh, she likes him.
She likes him. Must buy everything he does."
Right, exactly.
Meanwhile, on air, she's encouraging Jerry to fire him.
Yeah, right.
Lose the asshole that tried to kiss me.
Yeah. Lose the kissing dude.
So, Jerry, how long have you and this predator had this show? That is the worst, though, when you're going for like a little friendly peck on the cheek, and it's so not awkward. Warranted.
Have you ever had, now the pull arm down is bad enough. Have you ever had the head pull away?
Cheek turn.
Yeah.
Where they just give you ear.
It is. So I haven't had that in years. I learned very early on.
Yeah.
But I tried that once, like, I guess, I was with friends. I was a girl at her college,
uh-huh.
And around she introduces me to one of her friends, who I think is kind of cute and everything.
Yeah.
And I go in for the little handshake kiss, and she moved her head back like she was bobbing away from fucking one of Ali's punches.
And weaving.
Oh, she couldn't get away from me.
You're licking your lips and coming towards her.
Kiss me.
Did you get to her, or did you just...
No, I kind of just shook my hand, and then I think I even went like, "Hey, what's this over here?" Like, I was leaning in to look closer at a little tchotchke on her fucking night table. What an ass.
I like Hello Kitty, too.
Oh, it's so embarrassing.
Oh, brutal. Horrid. It's so embarrassing because you don't know it. And you, like, I was saying, I wasn't nervous, but that was a nervous thing. I'm just like, I saw her, like, "I gotta kiss her."
Did you get all hot? And
yeah.
Like you're sweating and red. Oh,
this was another panic moment, was that I had to fly out of here. It was the snowstorm last week, like Thursday or whatever. So I had to fly. We did the taping and then flew right out, like in the middle of the night, to get to Chicago because for the show. So my wife had to like pack my bag so I could just run right from the studio. So I was like, "Can you pack my toiletries?" So she packs my toiletry bag with nothing in it. So fast forward, I'm sitting backstage at Oprah. I've got no deodorant.
Oh, wow.
And I'm starting to sweat through my shirt.
No.
I'm in the bathroom putting tissues underneath my arms. I'm pitting out, and I'm about to go on Oprah. I just picture myself sweating through my suit. So I asked one of the crew people, "Do you have any deodorant?" And they come back with a big aerosol can of something pretty.
Fucking Glade.
Something pretty that the Oprah gals wear. So I'm spraying it. I come out smelling like a florist, but it's too late. I'm all ringed
you
up.
You already have the rings.
You know what saddlebagging is? A saddlebag is when you sweat so much that both rings meet in the middle. I was so close to saddlebag that I kept the suit closed like this.
Did you stink?
Hoping that I must have reeked.
That's great.
Sweating like Gleason.
Yes. Hard to believe she wouldn't want to kiss you happily.
Yeah, big sweating saddlebags coming after.
Yeah, who's the sweating smelly animal you brought with you? Fucking great. I love only a comic would have that happen to him.
Oh, yeah. Terrible. Yeah. I've never in my life had to put tissues as a barrier. Like sandbags. Like just trying to hold back the river.
I felt actual, like, what is that? Oh, it's a drip going down my side.
Oh, that's the worst.
All the way to, like, my pant waistline.
I've had that too.
It's like, been that nervous and just sweat.
It's like I'm raining in my shirt.
Yeah, that's great. That's not going to show up.
Right.
I'm raining under my shirt. Oh. This is fantastic.
Now, for some reason, my right armpit... More so gross. My right one is always more than the left. It's always like the indicator, like we're in trouble.
There's some shit happening.
Yeah. Oh, here we go.
Tell the left pit. There's some shit happening.
Buckle
it's on.
Up. Buckle
it's
on. Up. It's
yeah,
on.
It's coming.
The left one is stupid and just happy to be there.
I'm left fine,
leaning
right?
in for a kiss.
Yeah, she loves you. Go ahead, kiss her. And the right one's like, she wants to strangle you right now. Back up, stupid. Your fucking right pit really knows what's going on.
Oh, so awful.
So that's great. So you're on Oprah today. It's fucking amazing, man.
She was really, but you know what? talk about impressive. You know, I, like we did the show. The audience, the thing runs like clockwork. There's nobody sweating but me. I mean, it just runs like a machine.
Yeah.
And then after the end of the show, she starts talking to the audience. Who, how many people came from wherever? And people are like, Australia, New Zealand, Europe, and everywhere around the world. How long have you been on the waiting list for tickets? 10 years, 15 years. These people are just, I mean, incredible. It's just incredible what these people do. Just
years to get tickets?
Jim, 13 years.
People didn't
15
wait
years
that long to see Jesus to be healed.
Well, yeah, you're right.
And you know what?
Like 15 it's years.
Because he gave away loaves of bread. She gives away cars. Yeah.
And she knows it. You know what I mean? Like she knows what it mean, really genuinely means to these people. And she just sits there and talks to them, and just there's a power about
her. But why would she ask that unless it was a self-serving kind of, how long have you waited to see me? How long?
Right.
It does seem a tad self-serving. Just got to be honest there.
Yeah, right, exactly. And she's almost like rubbing it in my face.
Looks back at you.
Good luck trying to fill up the stress factory.
Yeah. Do you realize that when this lady put in for tickets, you were middling in Connecticut? How does that feel?
Yeah, right, exactly. You hadn't even started comedy.
She's the most powerful celebrity in the country. I mean, she really is.
She's got to be.
She absolutely
Who
is.
Who else?
No one else has the influence over other people and things. Like, this, just the spinoff.
No.
She has dumb doctors on her show, and they wind up getting multi-million-dollar shows of their own.
I know.
Books? Forget about it. She's literally, I'm reading fucking, Highlights magazine. Oh, great.
Right.
Goofus and Galleon. I love them.
It's crazy.
Yeah, she can sell anything. She's
powerful.
She puts on a show or something. It's successful.
How embarrassing, by the way, when she was in Paris last year. I think her show was off the air for a month or whatever.
Oh.
And Hermes, H-E-R-M-E-S, how do you say that? Hermes wouldn't let her in the store to shop.
No.
Oh, yeah, it was a huge thing, because there's certain blacks they kept out because of problems they've been having. So this is Oprah, and she's not as known there, and they didn't know who she was.
Well, it's like, welcome to a country that ain't the U.S.
They had no idea that they were saying no to, one of the richest, and the most powerful celebrity, and it was a humiliating experience for her. She was very embarrassed, but also the company. Took a fucking beating.
Did they make her use the other fountain, too?
It really was like that level of... It's that level.
I'm surprised she didn't demolish the company.
Well, she made
no
her
one shop there.
I'll buy it and destroy it.
I think the owner, whoever was in charge, took care of things.
He sounds like he might have been a tidy whitey.
Right back to the beginning.
Can we break for a couple minutes? I had to piss desperately.
Jimmy, anytime your little hummingbird bladder gets full, you tell me, I'll point to Travi, and we will go to a break so you can urinate.
Hummingbird bladder.
I piss. I was up four times last night.
Really?
Taking full stream pisses.
It might be a prostate thing.
I've thought that, believe me. I've been checked by enough prostitutes. My prostate is fine.
like they know what they're looking for.
Yeah.
Trouble is, it's covered in glitter nail polish.
There's a fingernail stuck in my prostate. Is that normal?
Can you check this for me? Yeah. Well, it goes in. As if that's what you mean.
No, I had a sonogram done. I had a sonogram done on my prostate and my bladder because it was so bad. I thought there might be. And they're like, no, normal size. I just piss a lot.
You just have a little baby bladder.
I just pee. I just, for some reason, there's something happening that makes me pee constantly.
Yeah. It's well, you drink a lot of water, which is very healthy.
Yeah, this is like my third bottle of water today.
Your hair's so long.
It's getting cut today.
So is it? You're going back down to... Yeah. Keeping it pretty tight these days.
Well, you know, Tom wastes his time on Oprah, but I have red eye tonight.
You know, you don't want to go in front of Greg and look like a piece of shit.
Yeah.
No, you want to look good. I don't want to sweat.
Don't kiss him on the way when you show up.
Why? He'd go for it. Have you done Gutfeld show?
No.
Oh, yeah. He's great. Yeah, he's really funny.
Yeah. Really good. Make fun of his big glasses.
He's got new glasses, right?
They're horrible. Yeah. I love them.
I saw the other... I did the show Thursday, and I saw the glasses and was like, what is... I thought he had a hidden camera in him and was doing like a bit for the show.
Yeah, it looks like furniture on his face.
Yeah, that's exactly it. Like modern fucking black formica.
All you need is to cover the eyeball. You don't need a giant shelf.
He's like, what are you trying to see, fucking Proxima Centauri? How bad bad of your eyes.
Jesus. It really is.
Like, you've got to make fun of him.
That's an I need a look purchase.
He is a blind son of a bitch.
That's absolutely. I'm working on a look.
Working on a look.
I'm working it through.
It worked for Drew Carey.
Tune in tonight and watch my fist remove those glasses. I'm going to do Greg and everyone a favor. And
use your little bladder and urinate on those giant glasses.
Yeah, I really should fire hose those glasses off his face. It's all for his own good.
It is for his own
those
good.
Those fucking giant glasses bug me.
They are very distracting when you look at them.
Yeah. It's like, well, I really think we ought to think, eyes! So we'll be back in a minute.
De Niro's glasses in the end of Casino were less distracting.
Dude, yeah. De Niro's explosion in the car was less distracting.
Yeah, let's take a break. Beforehand, though, definitely plug again. The show. What is it, Thursday?
10 o'clock on Thursdays on NBC.
Yes.
And also, Tom is also going to be on Oprah today, and we'll be back in a few minutes.
Yes, right back.
Great.
Oh.
Yes.
A little music to
Eminence Front.
Yeah. Look at illegal pornography, too.
Yes.
Things to clean your hard drive, too.
Yes. I was just researching a book.
I didn't even catch that.
Research. little research.
I'm just looking it up.
Yes. He'll never live that down.
No.
The guy is fucking Pete Townsend from The Who, windmilling on the stage of fucking Woodstock.
Uh-huh.
And it's come down to...
Oh, that dude.
The guy with the fucking credit card.
Right.
With the porno, kiddie porn.
The guy they took his computer out of his house, right?
Yeah, guy. That happened to the same guy, Gary Glitter.
Right, right.
It's The Who, and it's a giant catalog, and down, 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 hey! And that guy, in the same boat now.
Yep, same
what
thing.
What happened?
When's his
but
book
he was
coming
cleared,
out?
Right? He wasn't...
Yes. Yeah, but it
doesn't matter.
Cleared as stop. There's still a red pin mark on his Google map under Predators. Hey, but who doesn't have that?
Yeah.
I actually have one in my house. It's giant.
I remember.
Cooking in the...
Oh, right. It rains on the floor because of that giant pinhole.
Giant roof in through my house.
So, Pete Townsend's book that he was working on, I imagine it's coming out soon.
Oh, yeah, I'm sure it would. If he was working on the book, I would make that whole misunderstanding a giant part of the book.
Sure.
Yeah.
The book.
Yeah, the book, chapter 6. The police came to my door today.
Yes. I was doing a little research.
Yes.
All of a sudden, the door busted, and these fucking cops carrying that motherfuckers.
Yeah, we understand. All of a sudden, he's cockney.
I remember when he came out, and it was like, Pete Townsend's gay. Oh.
Is he gay?
I didn't
know that.
Yeah, Jim, he came out like 20 years ago.
I did not realize that.
Fitting. And I was like, really? he was gay? And then you look at his video for Rough Boys.
Rough Boys was hard
I
to take.
I want
to
bite that. And kiss you. And it was just like, I remember watching and thinking, oh, why didn't I get that when I was 17?
That was like Judas Priest, too, you know?
Yeah.
It's like, well, this is cool, but he's wearing like the same costume Pacino wore in Cruising.
Yeah,
right.
And
hell bent for leather.
For leather.
Oh.
I just thought
now
it was a
I
good
get
song.
It.
Yes, I just thought he was hell bent for a leather outfit.
I thought the lyrics were figurative in Fuck Me in the Ass with Your Fist.
Yes.
I thought it wasn't literal.
I thought it was a metaphor for a military invasion, but no. It was really get the glove.
Oh, he really meant it.
Yeah, he meant it completely literally. Tom, you're a married guy. I know Tom. I know his wife well for many years. She's a comedian. And I've never seen you guys argue. Like, you guys seem to have a pretty healthy, like, nice, like, you watch him and his wife together, and you don't feel like, marriage must suck. It's like,
those are the most dangerous ones ever. Yeah. Those are the ones where they explode behind closed doors where real damage can happen.
Right. We don't have, like, big blowouts. We just get quiet and cold.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like, we don't yell and scream, and we don't really argue about that much stuff.
What are the little things that might bug her about you and vice versa?
Barrier.
This is like a silly little thing, but anytime I go to read anything, like anytime I open a book, she sees it as a neon sign of "Let's chat."
What?
As soon as I start reading, she says, "And then now let's talk about everything." And I'll even do like the slow thing where I'll put my finger down while she's yammering. I'll put my finger like
yammering,
and then look up.
Yes.
And then look up slowly. Like I'm sorry, I missed what you said because I was reading.
You know what? That annoys them more than anything. I've been in conversations where girl is talking, and I didn't start watching TV in the middle of a conversation.
Right.
I was watching TV.
Right.
Girl comes over, starts a conversation. I'm in the middle of Forensic Files. I want to know where the hair came from.
Right.
So I will pick up the remote and hit pause and turn around.
Real slowly.
And now it's, oh, I'm not important enough to, like, I should miss the show because what she's saying is important. Me pausing is like, this is more important than you.
Yeah.
So I'm going to pause this to see what I'm missing during your drivel.
That's what drives them crazy. It's like, you're not paying attention to me is the whole thing. It's like, I'm in the room. How dare you look at anything
else? Anything
but me. A TV, a book. Anything.
Yeah.
I will actually cover my girlfriend's mouth with my hand. I really do that. When she starts yapping, I'm like, hold on. And I just put my hand over her mouth. I'm like, you got to stop yapping.
I've turned around and just gone, shh. Yeah, shut up.
They hate that. I do that too. I do the shook. Oh, that kills her.
But you know what it is? I would never do that seriously. It's like a joke to just kind of, you know.
Yeah.
Because obviously you're interrupting me. You're making me a little angry. I'll break the ice by going, shh.
Right.
And they get fucking pissed.
So angry. The worst is like when we, another time she likes to talk is when we're going to sleep. Wiped out. Heads on the pillow. Finally, the day is done. And then that's when she brings up the heaviest of heavy topics. Something about the kids or something about moving.
Yeah.
And I'm just like, shh. Don't shh me. Don't shh me. And now we're brawling in the middle of the night.
You guys yell? You don't yell when you argue?
No.
That's amazing.
No, we don't yell.
That's amazing to me. Like, you don't say horrible things to each other?
We actually have a no FU clause.
Wow.
In our marriage.
What's that mean?
You can say fuck you at any point or use fuck in a fight.
I jump right to cunt.
Jesus, I do.
So it's, yeah.
I leapfrog into fuck, over it, into childhood issues.
I don't know why we started it. It was very early, and we said that we have a no FU clause, and
have you
it
almost?
Kind of works. I have almost a couple of times. No, but no, we never did it. And I think it really... I think it amps the fight to just another place
that
we're
uncomfortable
with. Some people could be, like if she were to say it to me, it would be, you know, the whole world would kind of, some people can fight and it doesn't bother them. You know what I mean? It's just they're used to it and it's not a big deal. If we fight, it's like the earth is shaking a little
big
bit.
Big thing.
Yeah, yeah.
It's going to last for a while.
Right.
It's going to be weird feelings
afterwards.
And then
you said that's you.
Yeah, yeah.
So we just took it off the table.
How do you not let, this is amazing to me. How do you not let the anger overwhelm you? Like I say horrible shit when I fight, and so does anybody I date. Winds up getting roped into my disgusting world.
Your disease.
Your horrible world. They really do.
Oh, God.
And I can't comprehend living like the way he lives
you
is much better.
You fight all the time?
Nah, not really, no. I mean, I'm really bad at walking away from, like, I don't know how to just say, all right, I always feel like I have to win, and it's a terrible thing. So, like, instead of just going, hey, you know what, she's being a bitch today because she's cranky, let it go. And this is what every girl I've ever dated. And just walking away.
I've always been that airplane with the water in it that flies over the fire.
I want it done and put out as quickly as possible, even if I have to make concessions that make me fucking lip-biting angry.
Just wrap it up.
I'm like, look,
whatever.
I know I'm right. I know I won't say this. To myself, I said this.
Yeah.
I know I'm right. I know you're wrong. But the stress is more than this is worth.
Yeah, right. So, you just want it to be over.
You're right. But then I got to hear like, you're right, I'm right.
Uh-huh.
And then I'm,
but don't think, doesn't she get mad when you concede too easily?
No, because I make it seem like
you're fighting a little.
Yeah, yeah, I went down in the fifth. I was like, I'm like that fighter that just kind of, I threw the fight. Boos are coming from the boo!
Phantom punch.
Yeah, boo! She didn't touch you.
I do the same thing with the plane.
thing, but it's filled with gasoline, and I drop it on the fire.
That's exactly Jimmy. That's the total difference, man.
But I never see you. I see you get like, you'll get quiet, and I know when you're moody and stuff, but I never see you, like, snap at people or... I've never seen you raise your voice.
Because there's really... I have to be emotionally invested in something to be really... Like, if I'm arguing politics, sometimes it depends on how invested I am or how annoyed I am with the other person's point of view.
Right.
If it's something that I'm really hot about, then I'll argue for real. But
right.
A lot of times it just means nothing to me.
I'm more annoyed with somebody's misunderstanding of my point of view.
Yeah, you want to be heard properly.
Than I am with someone else's point of view being completely opposite of mine.
Yep. Right.
They don't get what I'm fucking trying to talk about. And this happens in marriages and relationships all the time. Uh-huh. It's like, do you understand what I'm saying to you?
Yeah.
I'm saying, you know, and then I'll explain myself, like, so specifically. And then I'll just get thrown at me this basic... white sheet of you're an asshole.
Right.
It's like, but I explained in great detail.
That's what's so amazing about watching all these couples come in and where you can evaluate whether they're going to be on the show or not. You have two people who have decided to live with each other. Apparently the closest person to you in the world.
Exactly, yes.
And you are miles apart.
Yeah, yeah.
Miles and miles apart.
You do not understand each other.
At all.
You could sit and talk with your friend and they there will be better understanding between the two of you than with someone you made a holy vow with to live forever and
sleep
give
next to
and sacrifice your life for and all this shit. And you look and go, I don't understand this person one iota.
At all. A complete stranger.
We're idiots.
Why would we
do that?
It's so bizarre. Oh, if it's some reason you stay in it.
Well, I didn't. Get me the fuck out.
Would you do it again?
No, I will never marry again. And I've said that time and time again. And other people go, you might find the right person.
Yeah.
If I find the right person, I will live together with somebody.
Uh-huh.
We will be exactly as if we were married, except this time I won't lose millions of dollars after the fact to somebody that I feel did not deserve penny one.
Wow.
Thank you. Don't get me started.
Oh, really?
Yeah, I got married when I was... doing sheet metal work and making $27,500 a year.
So she was with you on the way up?
Yeah, kind of. On the way, but not the whole way up.
Not the whole.
But then once I reached the whole way up, you know, people want to share in the whole way up, even though you weren't there.
Oh.
Yeah. One good thing, it would have been great. Oh, you'd have loved this for your show. I could have come on with me, my wife, and my girlfriend I brought home.
Oh, no.
Oh, who wins? Who wins?
Tell me, marriage ref.
Oh, this is good, marriage
ref. Let me make my case.
Who wins?
He never eats my pussy the way he eats hers, marriage ref.
Well, Aunt, you have to share the wealth.
You know something? There's nothing funnier than when you and your girlfriend are sitting on the couch and you watch your wife drunkenly fall out the front door.
A night to remember.
Don't talk about this on your program.
Let's put it in a promo reel.
That's fantastic.
You thought the stuffed dog was crazy.
An old man aunt will be alone. Jeff, that's terrible. Hold on, Jimmy. Jeff says old man Ant will be alone. You're alone today, not listening or watching the show.
Goodbye.
I love power. I'm like Oprah.
You're like our own Oprah.
Want a kiss?
The great thing is, too, you'll hear like all these fun problems. Like, you know, the motorcycles in the living room. Like, that's annoying. That's a real problem.
Yeah.
But then I just go to my fight. And I'm like, she called me a piece of shit. And I said, I hope you're dead before you're 30.
Oh, my God.
That didn't happen, but I mean, like...
But you know what? I could see that happening.
That level.
I wasn't surprised.
I never said that, but that type of...
Yeah, that type of hate. Do you feel like almost hatred when you're arguing?
I feel almost? Emotionless. Like, I can say anything.
You disappear. You can say anything without guilt.
It's an acting scene, which is dead and dangerous because you say anything.
Yeah.
And it's amazing the things that will bother a woman.
Right.
Like... We'll argue, right?
A hammer?
Yeah, well, that always bothers her. She's like, he wants a piece of cheese.
They hate that.
Yes. Yeah. I'm like Burt Johnson attacking Arthur. Good reference. Fucking 30 years ago, asshole.
It's a good one.
But it's like we'll argue, and this is with every girlfriend, and she'll say something to me, and I'll be like, you know, I don't even know why I'm dating you. There's no way I'll be dating you in a year.
Ooh,
and to me, that's such a general argument and a thing that could be said to anybody. That would mean nothing. If a girl said that to me, like, I won't even be dating you next year, she could literally say blueberry-flavored pie. And it would have the same emotional effect on me.
Really?
It means nothing to me because it's a general thing.
Right.
If you attack me specifically, that's what gets me. But like, if I say that to my girlfriend or other girl, that is a fucking,
literally
for months after. And you fucking asshole, you said we wouldn't even be dating in a year from now. Do you remember that?
Yeah, forever. She'll remember that forever.
She'll remember that, and a year
we
later
see
go,
that.
Ha ha.
Yeah.
Just get it. You see, we are.
We see it happen a lot on these couples that come in, and it's like we give it a term now. We call it going to the archives. It's like they're fighting about the Harley in the living room, but then all of a sudden they bring up something from a year and a half ago.
Is it usually the guy or the girl?
The girl goes to the archives.
Oh, what a file cabinet they
absolutely
have.
Deep.
Yeah.
Deep. You think,
they're going
that's
deep.
That's gone? No. They're going deep. That's a good term. For it.
I'm being emotionally audited.
Right.
She's coming back a few years.
Yeah. June 14th,
yes.
2000.
Do you remember no, I don't. And as guys, we just, like, at least me anyway, I forget what we argued about, why, which is so unhealthy and bad for a relationship. I know this.
But it happens all the time. Guys are always at a disadvantage because they have to figure out first what we're fighting about.
Yeah, what are we fighting about?
Yeah.
And is it worth it or should I end it?
Right.
That's pretty much how I am. And usually it is, like, end it.
Yeah, end it. Very few things are worth it.
Yeah, yeah.
Very few.
And Seinfeld said in an interview that he conceptualized the show when he was fighting with his wife.
Yeah.
And the friend was there, and the friend was going to leave, and he said something about, no, you referee this.
Mm-hmm. Wow.
And I can't picture him.
You end it.
You end it.
Yeah.
I can't picture him. Have you ever seen him yell at anybody or be angry? I can't picture him be any type of angry.
That's great, Seinfeld.
I've seen him angry. But he's not like, he's very controlled, you know what I mean? Like, he's not gonna be like, ah!
He's having an argument and a friend's there and it's a TV show. It's like, so I'm changing my oil! And I'm like, a TV show! This is great! To change the oil show! Anything.
Power.
Minus. Goddamn Midas.
Power.
I wonder how he said to the referee, could you referee this? He probably said, all right, you make the decision. Who's right? The wife or the one who's worth $400 million? And the friend wants to hang out with the one worth $400
million. Yeah.
I'd always be friends with the guy worth $500 million before I'd be friends with anybody who doesn't have
$500 million.
I don't
know what you did, but you must be right.
Yes. Whatever it is, if it makes the king unhappy, it's wrong.
It was, I think that was always in my marriage. I'm not sure what the giant problem was. Jack Daniels, but I think money was an issue where it became a point of like, so you're kicking in the $20 from tips tonight,
right?
And I'm doing this, yet I'm being yelled at for not taking the garbage out tonight,
right? Do you realize where all this comes from?
Yeah, I understand. I'm not being a prima donna about the garbage, but. I'm not taking out the fucking garbage.
Yeah, right. Yeah,
you exactly. Had all day to do
a
it.
A little help, yeah, exactly. A little help.
I don't give a shit.
Yeah.
Find a Mexican, pay him money.
Do you ever get jealous? Are you like, I'm a jealous guy over nonsense. Like, if I see you talking to the guy, that doesn't bother me. But
yeah, you don't seem jealous for things that guys are normally jealous of.
Yeah.
Some things I am, some things I'm not. But do you ever have to say, like, what the fuck was that? What did you mean by that?
Really?
That to him? Like, not like in a LaMotta way.
I was just going to say
No. Like, yeah, I don't mean wake her up.
Sugar's cup.
Quiet.
Vicky, you ever think of other guys? She's like, ah, she's sleeping. You know, we make love. He's just brooding with his bad hairdo. I don't mean that level of psychosis. But do you have those misunderstandings or do you just trust implicitly?
I've had relationships where I was jealous and this one I'm not. So I really think that it comes from... They provoke it. The girl will provoke you into jealousy.
Okay.
Like, they'll do things, talk to guys. They'll do things to make you a little unsettled, don't you think? It doesn't just come because of who you are. If they're cool and they know and they want you to be cool, they won't put you in a position by, like, talking to some guy too long or, you know what I mean? They provoke it.
I've misread things, though. I had a girlfriend she was talking to my manager. We were eating. Just joking around with him.
Was she eating his cock?
Yes. It was really weird. She was having something called a zipper sandwich. I hadn't heard of it.
But boy, I got this weird jealous feeling.
Yeah. Jealous. Apparently it's delicious.
It's unfounded.
Yeah.
But I said to her, my agent. I said to her after, I'm like, were you flirty with him? And she was like genuinely disgusted with me.
Ooh.
She's like, are you out of your fucking mind? No.
And she meant it. And I was like, oh, all right.
Wow.
And misread that one.
You fuck up.
But I asked. I didn't make a big accusation about it.
I used to get ridiculously jealous because I was, during my younger years, I was of the mindset that if I slept with a girl, she was my girlfriend. For, like, I wasn't one night stand guy.
Right.
I slept with a girl. We went out for like 5 years.
I was the same way.
It was just, that was the way it went.
Yeah.
And it would make me so jealous. Like the thought of her having sex with somebody else was, I couldn't keep it in my head.
Right.
Right.
Like, and then we'd break up and I'd be fucked up.
And you make it happen.
Yeah. It was my fault, of course. And then the next girl again, sex. 3 year relationship. It was like, I don't know. And I've just recently, I think, gotten to the point where I don't do that anymore. And, and as it was said in Ferris Bueller, I think sex is the be all end all of what a girl could give you.
Yeah, right.
And it's just, it's, that's not it anymore.
No.
It just, it reached that point though, finally. And I'm glad that happened because it's just too much fucking shit on your mind.
But
all
isn't
the time.
It amazing how many years it took to get to that peace of mind?
It was forever.
Forever.
I look back and go,
forever.
Fuck, man.
Who was I?
What was I thinking?
Yeah.
What the fuck was I doing? How much pussy did I miss out on?
I know.
Fuck!
I always think of that in, what was it, with Sunshine, with the Alan Arkin.
Oh,
the Sunshine State? I didn't see it.
Yeah, Sunshine.
Little Miss Sunshine. Little Miss Sunshine and Alan Arkin. Did you see it?
No.
Alan Arkin. Alan Arkin's giving advice to the teenage grandson of his. And Alan, I just have one thing to say. Fuck a lot of women. A lot of women. And he laughs. He goes, no, I'm serious. I am not kidding.
That's his
advice. Lot of women. If I had known then, just a lot of women.
That was his advice.
That was his advice to his grandson.
It's great and it's true.
It's true.
You don't ever want to regret passing it all off for some fucking lump.
Yeah.
They keep saying Tom has to go. I guess you have to go.
I do. I got to roll.
You're out, Tom.
You're out, Tom.
Thanks, maybe. Boys. This
maybe
is
I
great.
Can help. So, Tom, the plug, The Marriage Ref is on. It premiered last night after the Olympics, and it's on every Thursday, 10 o'clock. And I didn't know this. It's an hour show from 10 to 11, and the guest lineup, man, is truly phenomenal. And Tom's really a funny dude. So it
thanks,
sounds like
Jimmy.
A great show, and I'm happy for you, man. You
I appreciate it. Thanks, guys.
I'm glad you didn't bring Jerry by, too. That would have sucked.
Yeah, no.
Who needs
maybe
him?
Next time.
But no,
who needs him here?
Tom's a funny fuck, man.
Mucking
really,
up the joint.
Oh, we'll just be ruining it with his brilliant comedy.
But, making us go in a shell like a turtle's we are.
Are we ready to go to a break? We'll do that, and then we'll come back and have more fun and shenanigans.
Yes.
Thank you, Tom.
Thanks,
Tom on Oprah today as well.
Absolutely.
Nice. Disturbed. Ooh, a little wowing going on. I like that from Monday. Oh, Danny missed it. Danny missed it. Could you show him, please? There you go. Here they go. God damn, man. She has the magnificent breasts. Jesus H. Christ.
Wow.
Jesus H. Christ.
Those are lovely.
Yeah, I know. Wow. All right. Opie and Anthony show. Little distraction there. Just a little minor distraction in between the commercial breakage and the show startage. Opie's been out this Monday. I think Olympic. You got Olympic fever, they call it. Olympic fever. The hockey game last night between USA and Canada. Does everybody know the results? I don't know what happened. Of course, Canada won. Very disappointing. Even though I'm not a hockey fan, I found myself just captivated by it. And very disappointing. I thought when they scored with only 24 seconds left, was it? I thought it was destiny. I thought it was going to be one of those destiny moments where it has to happen. Like the movies. But life isn't like the movies, alas. Life is not like the movies. You can get chlamydia.
It's like Forrest Gump said, life is like a box of chocolates.
Yeah.
And I have shitty legs.
And a wife with AIDS.
Yeah, and a mother with cancer. Jesus, what didn't they have in the Gump family?
A whore mom that fucks the teacher, right?
Fuck the teacher from the school so old Forrest could go to school.
So how
she paid the tuition.
So happy you bailed me out of my awful joke. Thanks, guys. Thanks, Danny and Ann, shipping in. Bailing a friend out.
Hey, you can't lose with a Forrest Gump thing. Someone's going to pick the ball up.
How did I bomb on a Gump joke? Because I stink.
Hey, let me give myself one of these.
Oh, a wacky horn, James. That was good.
I love Tom.
And Tom is good on the show.
Tom's a fucking solid comic, too, man.
I've never seen him live.
He's very clean. It's like a guy like that, he belongs. A
guy like that's going to go far.
He belongs on TV. I mean, he really does. Like, he belongs doing a show because his humor is, he's not a pig. He's not cleaning up for TV. That's like really the way he is. So yeah, he's perfect for a show.
Yeah.
He has a healthy marriage. Really bugs me. He's friends with Seinfeld. Clint Eastwood loves him. I told you that's the
Clint
guy.
Clint Eastwood. Oh, wait a minute. You told me about him.
That's the guy who does Clint Eastwood's private party. He loves him.
Jesus Christ.
And Seinfeld met Eastwood, and I think he brought up Papa. Like, he's like, hey, you're friends with Tom, I'm friends with Tom. And I thought it was the funniest thing that fucking Seinfeld had to use the same opening line to Eastwood that I would have, which is Tom.
Although, I don't think it would have worked as well.
No, because he would have just probably pissed and not shaken my hand as opposed to going, off. Jerry!
The blow-off. God, that kissing thing, though, is...
That's, how great is that?
Oh, just having been there, where you just think you can lean in and give that kiss... There's nothing worse than thinking you're doing the right thing or even being suave or cool. And it doesn't matter how long ago it happened to you. Like, there are embarrassing moments that stand out in my mind, and I cannot shake them. You think back, and the douchiness of the moment creeps up on me so much.
I told you, when I wanted to kiss my little girlfriend, Jill, I was in maybe fourth grade or fifth grade. And I didn't have, we were boyfriend and girlfriend, I thought, but I didn't know how to kiss her. And my father's advice fucking was horrendous. My father said, what you do is ask her if you can smell her breath. And when she breathes in your face, kiss her.
A rapist.
That really is. It's like, wow, thank you, shittiest advice in history. So I didn't do that. So we're down by the creek one time. I'm like, I got a question for you. And she's like, what? I'm like, well, I want to do something. And she's like, what do you want to do? I'm like, well, you know my favorite group?
Oh, no. You wanted to Ozzy her? You wanted to Black Sabbath her?
No. Oh, you know that.
Of course I know. Oh, no, you didn't say that.
And she just never answered. Is that embarrassing?
Oh, I am you brought silence. That, because everybody had to dwell on the embarrassment. Yeah. That is really bad.
It was humiliating. And I've never shaken that one. I've never, that might have been fifth grade. I've never shaken that one off.
That is a bad one.
My favorite group.
Oh.
What, douche?
I have a douche moment that I cannot fucking shake. I was probably 17, and my mother was working at some fucking rowdy nightclub place with a bunch of disco fucking assholes in it and shit like that. And I would occasionally put on a oversized, bad-fitting, ill-fitting, mismatched suit to try to get into the place because I thought, you know, I was going to get some chicks in the disco. So I went in there, and I saw a couple of girls in there from school. And I thought, this is perfect. So I start talking to the girls, and I kind of get one that I really liked. And her name is Crystal. Her name is Crystal Piatnik. Crystal Piatnik, where are you from John Glenn? I hope you're fat. I hope you're big and fat now. So I'm talking to her, and she goes, me and my friend have to leave for a few minutes, but we're coming right back. I was like, okay. I waited outside the place, standing there in my bad suit, waiting for her car to come back.
How long did you wait for? About 10 minutes, 15 minutes?
Over an hour. And then I realized they're not coming back.
They blew you off?
Yeah. But, okay, that's part one of the embarrassment. Part two is Anthony then decides, because of this embarrassment that I have to weigh myself down with, I'm going to go back into the bar and drink like a motherfucker. So I get hammered doing tequila. And one of the women that worked with my mother as a cocktail waitress in there was really hot, blonde, much older than I was at the time. You know, I'm 17, something like that. She was probably 35. And I'm looking at her, and I'm all drunk. And I went to just, I go, I'm going to give her a kiss. So she comes by me with, like, a tray, and I blurted out, I love you, and went to grab her and knocked all of the glasses over. They broke all over the bar. And then I couldn't even, like, get up off of the bar. I was so fucking drunk, and I had to be driven home.
Were you embarrassed when you remember that?
Dude, I could never face that woman again, and I mean my mother. No, I could never see her again. Anytime I heard she was going to visit, like, my mother just stopped by the house, she was going to come by since Saturday, I had to leave. I was so embarrassed that I said, I love you, and went to kiss her and knocked every drink glass off of her tray. Yeah. And they were all laughing. Like, all the waitresses were laughing because it was just funny. They thought it was, like, cute.
Cute.
That the drunk kid was trying to, like, kiss the... Oh, this is so bad. I am such a douche. Oh, look, we got phone calls of douche moments.
Oh, yes.
Why don't we take calls? We haven't done that at all today.
I would like that a lot.
All right, let's go to Jersey and talk to Mike. Mike!
Good morning, boys. How are you?
Good, Hi, how are you, Mike?
I'm a fucking douchebag. My mother made me go to her mother's father's funeral when I was 14. So here we are. I'm like a glad-handing retard my first time going to a funeral. And at the end, you know, you do the line, the kiss, I'm sorry. I didn't know to say I'm sorry. They were like, thank you for coming. I'm like, I really enjoyed it.
Today. Oh, that'll stick with you.
I'm a fucking flaming a-hole.
I really enjoyed it. A great party.
Yeah. Fucking dead corpse in a box. And I'm like, yeah, can we have tea and coffee?
Good job. Good job, Mike.
Thanks, boys. Punching out.
Hey, let's go to line two and talk to Stryker. Stryker.
Morning, boys.
Hi, hey. Stryker.
Happy birthday, Jimmy.
What's up, buddy?
I can top Anthony's douchey moment of waiting outside the club.
Good luck.
I was a junior in high school. There was this girl that I was in, like, three classes with, and I really liked her, and I thought we got along great in school. So I asked her out on a date. She gave me her phone number and said, call me Friday, and I'll let you know. I called her Friday. Her mom says, I'll take a message. She'll call you back. She never called. Well, she never called.
Who is this, Rocky Dennis? Calling?
The blind girl felt your face with a fucking rake and told her father, look, if that fucking giant-headed mongoloid calls, pretend to be a dick.
Yeah. So you were in love with Laura Dern. What happened?
Well, exactly.
On Monday, I asked her about it. She goes, you know what? I forgot. She said, but we can go out this weekend. So I called that Friday, the next Friday. This time, nobody answered. I kept leaving messages on her answering machine.
Ugh, you don't want to leave messages like that.
Yeah, well.
No,
there's nothing worse than a message from somebody you don't want to hear from. You're like, just fuck off.
That's douchey, but that does not beat I love you and dropping glasses
no,
everywhere.
No, it does not.
My booze-stained, ill-fitting suit.
I did it 4 weeks in a row.
Oh, 4 weeks in a row? I mean, well, you're an asshole, but
yeah, Anthony's my worst moment.
Sorry. Thank you, Stryker.
Okay.
I like the chick ones. Let's go to Cody in Indiana. Cody.
Hey, what's up, brother? Jim Norton, March 12th in Chicago area.
Thank you very much. And the 13th, God damn the thought of you. Thank you, Cody.
I'm not going to that one, so I don't give a hoot.
Oh.
You're going to St. Charles.
St. Charles?
Man. Remember me, Cody from Indiana.
I will remember you, young Cody.
You're a liar. Anyway, I called with one, but I thought of a more douchey one. It was with a girl that I liked in sixth grade. And
you were a substitute teacher? Sorry, Gav.
We're not taking hot stories.
So I asked her out. She said no. So I took a piece of paper and I wrote on it, I love you. Will you go out with me from your secret admirer in locker 2B? And I put it in her locker.
she never found it, but her friend did, and she came up to me and said, hey, you're the Hawker 2B, right? And I said, yeah. She goes, you're a fag.
You're a fag. You tried something clever, and you got called a fag.
I said, I didn't write that. And she goes, you're Locker 2B. And I said, no, I didn't write that ever. And, yeah, it was me, and I am a fag.
And even though you probably could have convinced her it wasn't you and that one of your douchey friends set you up, you knew deep down it was you, and you were indeed a fag.
And she knew. There's no fucking getting around that bullshit.
Yeah, I know.
See you guys later. Have a good one.
Fucking chicks. They had it all. Thanks, Cody.
I think I've told this story before, but this is in high school now.
Ooh,
my first one was excusable.
Yeah.
Where I kind of had a crush on the girl, and I did what he did, where I would send her a couple of notes. And, like, if you want to know who I am, like, I'll drop them in her mailbox at her house. I would say, wear, like, a scarf. And she would wear a scarf. And I wouldn't tell her. So I wrote her one love note. And I asked somebody in Spanish how to write Speak of the Devil, because that was Ozzy's new album, and I wrote it in Spanish at the bottom.
Maybe if you just laid off the fucking music and band references, you might have done a lot better back in the day, as they say. What were you thinking?
I'm embarrassed.
Well, you should be.
I don't know.
Oh, that's horrible. That's terrible.
It's not that bad, I guess, but I'll never forget this moment.
If you're never gonna forget it. It's douchey.
Yeah. You're growing up, you're going through junior high school, then you start to, kiss the opposite sex goodbye. Like, it's like, oh, I'll see you later. Mwah, kiss on the cheek. Yeah. So we're all hanging out, you're just standing around the schoolyard, we're all in kind of like a circle or a semicircle or whatever. And for whatever reason, I had gotten it in my head that, one of the chicks that we were hanging out with was, leaving to go somewhere else to hang out with someone else. So I leaned in, I give her a kiss on the cheek.
Oh, no.
And she just goes, what was that for?
Oh, no.
And I was just like, oh, you're leaving, right? And she's like, no.
No.
And I was like, oh, I thought you were leaving. So in a group of 10 kids, I just leaned over and kissed some girl for no reason.
For no fucking reason. All right, that's embarrassing. That's
creep.
A little douchey. I'm sure Sam has no douchey moments in his perfect life with a girl or anything awkward.
I can't think of...
No, Mike. That's good. That's an awkward moment.
I can't think of anything with a girl off the top of my head.
A boy.
But yeah.
A grown man. So you and Bob Kelly are making out, and what happened?
So you're in a van looking out the window hoping your parents see you. And Otis Tool is driving quickly.
But I was always... very small in high school.
Slight of frame.
As opposed to now.
Well, I mean, I was also very short, too.
You're no Tank Hankerus.
No. But, and very immature looking. So I wasn't anybody that girls would look at as a candidate. So I was walking away from the school once, and the cool Hispanic kids were on the stairs going, yo, 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 Sam, she wants your number. She wants your number. And I was already humiliated because I understood that their idea of a joke was the possibility that this girl would want my phone number.
Yeah.
And so I said, yeah, right. And they said, no, Sam, what is it? What's your number? And I turned around and looked at them and said, 911.
You should have called that as they were bashing Colt 45 bottles against your fucking forehead,
knifing you with a shiv they made in shop.
I turned around so quickly because it hit me as I said it.
Good one.
It couldn't have been worse.
Did they comment on your great comeback?
911. Okay, just let me walk away in shame.
You should have been beaten.
I should have. I wish I had.
Yeah. Aww. Wow, a lot of people seem to have... I thought everyone was perfect.
Apparently a lot of people do stupid things.
Very stupid things.
Who would have thunk?
I like line two, maybe. Mark. South Carolina. Hey, Mark.
Hello, boys.
Hey. What's up, my friend?
Hey, buddy.
Yay, pudding.
Good.
Hold on, sir. 2 seconds. let me explain how badly Danny has just fucked up.
I did what Jimmy did last week.
He had an awkward moment in studio. In studio, he just had an awkward moment. Of course, before you fart, you have to say yay, pudding. And he said yay, pudding. And we all looked. He went to grab the mic and pulled it right out of the cord.
The mic cables are too damn short in this place.
So a dead mic was by his ass as he farted and no one heard it.
Yeah, talk to management and see if they can find a cord that will feed into your asshole comfortably.
I need a headset mic for my butthole.
For your ass, to wrap it around like a belt. Mark.
Yes.
Sorry for the interruption. You have
not a problem.
A little douchey little tale.
Yeah, well, the girl that was very hot named Gina just was pursuing her. She was a nice girl pursuing her, kept asking her out. Finally, one Friday night, I called and said, hey, do you want to go out? And she says, well, hey, how would you like to get some pizza with me? I said, sure. I got so excited, called my parents, called my friends. I was so excited, put on my best clothes. I mean, I was just ready, so excited. She came, picked me up. Oh, I was so excited. We're going to the Pizza Hut. We get there, she comes up, says her last name, and I said, here you go. Hands her two pizzas, and I look at her, and she said, I'm picking up dinner for me and Mom. You didn't think we were going out, did you?
Ew, oh. You got used. That's all that is. That isn't douchey. That's you being really stupid. What did you tell her?
I said, well, I didn't say anything.
Did you pay for it?
My head in shame.
Did you pay for it?
No. She paid for it, but I felt like an idiot because she said, I'm going to get pizza. Do you want to come? And I'm thinking, well, sure, yes.
Oh, like a little date. And then she was just getting pizza for herself and her family, and you were not involved.
Exactly.
All right. That's pretty douchey on your part. All right. Now I get it. I misunderstood. I thought she bilked you into paying for her pizza without giving up the pussy.
Pizza for pie.
That's what I say.
And trust me, it was about a year before I got to live that down.
Oh, God.
But it feels good knowing now that she's fat, has three kids, and divorced.
That's nice. At least a little justice happens in life. First time. I'm reading other calls because, you know, I'm doing a call post-screener screening.
Pre.
It's post-screener. It's past the screener. Now it's on me.
Oh.
Now I'm screening the screen calls to see which ones to go to because the lines are lit like crazy.
That's what I get for trying to correct Anthony. I was wrong.
Chris in Baston.
Hey, boy. How are ya?
Very good, sir. What's up?
Well, all right. Well, when I was a freshman in college, we went to a local nudie joint up in Rhode Island. Ooh. And that was my first time ever to a strip joint. It was just a topless place. And so I'm sitting by the stage all excited, and the girls are walking around topless, and the girl comes down to me, and my friend's like, you're supposed to give her a dollar bill. So I take out my dollar bill, give it to her, she puts her boobs in my face, and I go to kiss her nipple and suck on it. And she pulled it away, and everybody in the whole place just looked at me, and they go, what the fuck are you doing?
She went in for the titty grab on the buck?
Yep,
you know how they do that? Strippers will take a tit in each hand and lean over the bar, and then you put a dollar out, and they squeeze it between the tits and come back. But he went to nurse. He thought he was getting a dollar's worth of high test. What the fuck are you doing, you asshole?
I was pretty much banned to the back of the room and couldn't go to the stage.
You're lucky a biker didn't cave your head in. That's usually what happens when you abuse the dancers in such a manner.
Yeah.
Well, that's
my douchey moment. So I'm going to go eat a bullet now. So thanks for the time, boys.
You do that. Thanks, man.
Have a bunch of help.
Later. Speaking of, look at the segue. Eating bullets, that would be suicide. And suicide? How about boner?
Yes.
Who knew? What a horrific scene that must have been. And make your own jokes. I mean, come on.
Well, Boner was strangled.
Yes.
Boner hung himself. Sounds to me like he's acting like a real dick.
It makes sense, though, because Boner is a dick, and Dick hung. They, you know, you say you're hung. He must have been well hung.
What do you mean?
No,
Boner was doing this. He's just acting like a bunch of dicks.
No, it's because he hung himself. That's the funny part was that his name is Boner and hung. Are you well hung? Hung is usually used as a term for how big a penis is.
See, now, but Boner should have just killed himself by hiding a pair of blue jeans or something.
It made no sense. How about hiding in a pair of blue jeans? How could you kill yourself that way?
I don't know.
Yeah, what? Yes. Wow, that sounds like a nightmare because they they all the friends and family and I guess some authorities went searching for him in this park, and they went into the wooded area of this park and found young Boner hanging by the neck until dead from a tree.
The reason he was probably hanging is because people still call him Young Boner.
Young Boner. He's like 40 years old and has a name. And yeah.
It's not Boner Stabone.
Dude, that name killed him. Boner Stabone is what killed Boner. You think it'll be on his tombstone?
It'll definitely Boner. Just say Boner on his tombstone.
Or at least his first name, Boner in quotation marks, yes. Last name.
As if it wasn't just the character's nickname, but
yes,
his name.
Yes, he is in essence Boner. So they found him, and then they called over Walter Koenig, or Koenig, or however the hell he pronounces his name, Chekhov. They called him over, and he actually saw his son hanging from a tree.
What, they had to confirm, hey, is this your kid dead, or should we call?
Exactly. Well, they I guess whoever found him put out the word on the cell phone that he had been found, and everyone came running over. But geez, maybe you could hold Chekhov back and he doesn't have to see that mess. Boner just swinging in the breeze.
Well, what Chekhov did.
Mm. I don't know. What? I would have beamed out of there.
Yeah, me too. He probably would have check him off the list or something.
that's funny. Check off. Chip's too funny today.
Yeah, you better start calling him Captain Kirk or something to help you out.
Help you out. You're an asshole. I wanted to hear about the Jehovah's Witness, Scott from Mackie Two Shits. Scott!
Oh, my God.
Hi, how are you?
Oh, I'm picking up, a booger. There you go.
What's up, sir?
My nose is very crusty. Sorry.
Yeah, Jimmy's digging with a tissue. Isn't it a great feeling, though, when you take the tissue, twirl it in a nostril, pull it out, and it feels like your frontal lobe is coming out of your nose?
It is.
Because you are really getting a nice... And then your nose is clear.
It feels like you have a fucking brainstem wrapped around your finger.
Yes, it's wonderful. But I have to do it with a tissue. I cannot use just a finger.
I had to scrape nail to get that one off.
No.
It's
his
birthday nugget.
Touching it makes me feel very weird. You could isolate that, I guess. So what happened to you growing up a Jehovah's Witness, sir?
Okay, my mom was a Jehovah's Witness till I was about 13 when I moved in with my dad.
Mm.
And I was crazy in love with this girl, Jamie, from kindergarten all through high school. And so when I'm finally grown up and I think I'm a rock star, I'm in a band, I got the sports car, all that crap. And part of the Jehovah's Witness edict is you don't salute the flag because you don't pledge your allegiance to man.
Man!
You pledge your allegiance to God.
Right.
So here I am, this wonderful little kid, embarrassed my whole life that every time all the other kids are saluting the flag, I have to explain to the teacher, I can't do that because it's against my religion, you know?
Right.
So this wonderful creature, Jamie, I bump into her when I'm 21, and I think I'm happening, pocket full of drugs, all that shit. And I see her in a bar. I'm like, hey, Jamie, what's up? And she goes, aren't you that kid that couldn't salute the flag?
Oh, that's all she remembered.
That was it. That was my end.
That's all she... That's why you got to be so careful in school. Thank you, sir. Thank
You're
you
welcome.
For your... little story, because it just reminds me. Thank you. Yes, how many times are we going to thank each other?
It really was an endless string of courtesies.
We didn't just fucking have sex here, sir. You got to watch what you do in school, because you will be tagged something. I mean, there are people that I still refer to as throw-up girl. Because she threw up in the cafeteria. If you're going to throw up in school, it better be alone in the bathroom, and you better get out before anyone smells fucking spaghetti and meatball lunch, because you will be throw-up guy or throw-up girl.
Once I'm in high school, I totally got away with it. Like, I knew, I felt that I was going to
puke. You got away with puking?
Totally. I knew I was going to puke, so
throw-up
I just,
boy.
I was very calm. I got up. I said, yeah, I got to, you know, can I get the bathroom pass or the hall pass, whatever it was.
Were you turning, like, green?
And I didn't want to run, because I knew that would throw, you know, it would give me away, so I just started walking down the hall. I was like, oh, I'm totally puking. I looked around. There was no one around. puked all over the floor, all over the floor.
You came so close to being that guy.
And then no one saw it, and I just went to the nearest classroom, opened the door, I was like, yeah, I don't know if you want to get somebody. Someone totally puked all over the hallway.
Oh, wow.
Got out of that one scot-free.
You helped.
No one ever knew.
You helped out the janitor.
And I got the heat off of me. I was just like the guy that found it instead of the puker.
Damn, man.
Nice.
That is good because you could be puke, but yes, sir?
I had a friend in fifth grade who not only was he the gay kid, but then one time we made him laugh so hard that he pissed himself.
Friend. Huh?
It wasn't me.
Oh,
I wasn't the gay kid.
I've seen these in after school specials. You don't have to say friend. It's okay, Sam.
No, it wasn't me.
All right, we'll let you. Friend. Okay.
But then we also made him laugh so hard that he pissed all over himself in fifth grade and had to hide in a closet.
And did he get it all over his wrestling figures?
No, it wasn't me.
He hid in the closet. Yeah. Yes, it took me quite a while to come back out. It all comes back around to Steve.
He is the gay kid.
We had a girl in the cafeteria, too. The cafeteria is like a fucking war zone of puke and other bodily functions. We had some girl, and instead of giving this girl sympathy, she had like leukemia or something awful, and she's still going to school, which I never understood with parents, especially back then. That was like fucking terminal. Now, you know, they could cure some of that shit, but back then you get the shingles or the scurvy or the vapors or something and you're dead. But she had like leukemia, so she's sitting in the chair, and it was quiet enough in the cafeteria where it sounded like a pipe started leaking. You could hear water, and everybody just got dead silent and looked over, and from her chair, it was just because it was one of those plastic chairs that have the holes in the vent holes in the bottom, and water is just pouring out. Urine is just pouring out on the floor, and she's sitting there, but she was still eating, like she was like, I'm not, like, no one noticed, but everyone noticed, and she became piss her pants girl. But I guess that was better than leukemia girl.
Yeah,
she went from leukemia girl to piss her pants girl. And leukemia girl wasn't even that nice. It was like dying girl. Which is just horrible. Kids are just awful.
I just remember when I was in like, or when my brother was in like first grade, he used to get off the bus every single day, and every single day he would throw up. And all the teachers, that like the girl was in charge of the young kids would go and pick him up. He'd just throw up on his suede boots.
What the fuck is wrong with them?
You just get motion sickness on the bus.
I thought it was from your dad's fucking wonderful treat food.
No. Except my mom made us take cod liver oil before we went to school.
All right, that's why he was puking.
Yeah, she
little
made us.
Kids don't need cod liver oil. What was it? What is your mom, from the Little Rascals?
We wouldn't swallow the pills, so she would open the cod liver oil pills into our apple juice and make us drink the whole glass.
Christ. I wish your mom was Mrs. Goebbels.
Yeah, or Mrs. Smith, or fucking, or Mrs. Yates.
Save us a lot of trouble.
Sure would. Cod liver oil is good for you.
Is it?
Yeah.
What's it do for you?
I'm not sure.
I think it's supposed to be good for heart health and cholesterol, but, you know.
They told him it was cod liver oil. Yeah. He had to drink it out of a funny, fleshy stem. It's good for you, Samuel.
Yeah.
How about you and your chick? Do you guys fight a lot? I meant to ask you this before.
We don't fight a lot, but we definitely fight.
You yell?
Usually not, unless she's just being frustrated or hypocritical, or like, you know, when she's yelling at me for something that she does, then I'll really start to throw it back at her.
Wow, what do you mean by throw it back at her?
Well, that's when I start yelling and saying, look, then I break everything down and like talk to her like she's a child.
How do you yell? Give me an example. Okay, here's what happened. She didn't make your little fishy sticks,
okay,
right?
That doesn't...
Right? Okay. She didn't put enough ketchup on your plate for your little fishy sticks. And you're very angry, Sam. Sam is so very angry.
She wants. That's not the way it works.
I just get not. I don't even get acknowledged.
No.
All right. Here's what really happened.
She wants. I don't yell. I just look at her dead in the eyes and like we'll talk with my hands,
like a twink's eyes,
vacant, vapid, idiot's eyes.
And I'll talk down to her, not yell.
Oh, they hate.
Oh,
that.
you'll talk down to her.
I'll get her to yell.
Give me. I want an example of what this feels like. Get into character. Let me know what that's like.
Like, you just have to look. Do you understand that you're not smarter than me? You realize that, right?
Now, you lock eyes like you're doing right now?
Yeah.
And Sam's eyes are opening up a little wider than usual, and he's punctuating with his hand.
Yeah.
Like, do you understand?
Yeah.
Oh.
And is she now? How is she? Is
she's
she,
too hot to take that shit from the likes of you.
How
pal.
Is she responding to you? Is she telling you that you're a pompous ass?
She's got quite a temper.
Yeah.
Does she?
She'll a hot tamale.
She'll yell. She'll use more foul language
she'll
than
go
I will.
Like, fuck you.
Yeah. She'll start. Yeah. She yeah. will curse. She will yell. She will
she could
throw
point,
things and slam.
She could point to right between her legs and go, "You'll never get this again." And you'll be like, "I'm sorry." Because you know you'll never do better than her.
No, but in that moment, I will never admit that.
She wins. She wins.
Ultimately, she yes.
She knows no matter how stupid you look trying to talk down to her, that yeah. she holds the cards. The V card.
But this is why I work so hard to make her think that she doesn't.
Good luck with that.
Yeah.
You ultimately, are so out of your class with her.
Ultimately, yes.
But way out of your fucking grade.
We try to go case by case.
Way out of your rank.
I can't picture Sam talking dirty.
No.
You verbal in bed?
Not terribly.
No? What's no. something you'll say in bed?
He's verbal in bed like from Usual Suspects.
I don't know.
the cripple fucking. right. Didn't quite work, but at least Danny left. Say, I just don't say.
What would you say that's dirty? I can't picture you being dirty.
Thank you for the car crash.
I don't even really, like... The things I say that I know are mistakes immediately, she'll say something and I'll say, "What did you say?" I immediately.
Wow.
What? And then.
What, you don't talk when you fuck?
Not a lot, no.
Not a lot of talking.
Just the.
Is it the basic?
Do you like that?
Oh, and, baby. Oh, that feels so good, yes. sweetheart.
Do you say loving things?
No. I'll say, "You are so hot." Ooh. Things like that. Very basic.
You're That's hotter horrible. Than you're hotter than the fish sticks were tonight.
That's a good one.
Is that it? Yeah.
Oh, yeah, shit. Boy. I tell girls sometimes they'll get you so wet down there you're gonna think it's a whole bunch of legs in your underpants. One time she had me so aroused. I'm like, if this thing gets any hotter, we're gonna have to put it with a bunch of steel on the aisles and the shelves.
You're an ass.
You are so hot. That's horrible.
I don't talk a lot. I mean...
Oh, my God. Look at this. We're getting reports. Sam just repeats, "I love the cock."
Why would I say that?
Because you're getting cock.
No, it's... Oh. Why would I get that?
Because you're during sex. I thought...
I'm a heterosexual man.
Oh, okay. I'm sorry. I thought you were getting cock and you'd say, "Oh, please."
No.
Do you
no.
realize you're so hot? Do you realize a trainer was killed at SeaWorld has the same sexual value as that?
You really are a pro, though. You talk dirty?
If someone likes the way I talk dirty, I'm a pro. If they don't, I'm just a repulsive, repetitive piece of shit.
Do you feel bad if you have to be repetitive? Like, I
depends.
That.
I mean, it depends on what the, like,
there's
sometimes.
So much you could say.
Yeah, we've been dating for almost 5 years. I mean.
Sometimes you set somebody up for what you want them to say. Like, you ask the key questions. Like, I could never go, "Look, say this."
Yeah, yeah.
So I'll
yeah.
say something about, like, "Well, what happened if I quote you fucking somebody?" Like, if that's
see,
the thing.
I don't like that. Though.
No, because I know I want the answer to be. And then
see,
I talk.
But I don't know. Yeah, that's weird. Fucking talk.
Why?
Because it's bringing other things in. It's almost role playing talk. Like, because what is there a guy? I mean, you know, that's the whole thing.
Well, that's a little different.
I think it's more like the romantic but dirty talk is cool. But there's only so much you could do. Like I said, how far can you go before it's just like, "You stupid fucking monkey, I'm fucking you." Like, just something out of the blue. How do you say what? Because it's always the same. Oh, it's so good. It's so good. As opposed to bad. Like, how fucking good is it going to be? It's so good.
No, you don't do that. You fucking squeeze the bottom of her face, and if your girl's giving you a head, and you tell her, "Relax your mouth, wet her, get it wetter, get my car." Yeah, get fucking nasty. Show her who's boss.
No, there are certain things. There are phrases for blowjobs, phrases for fucking. Phrases for 69, phrases for fucking from behind.
What do you say for 69? I'll say something like,
what do you say, Chip?
Hey, let's do a 20 times 3 plus 10 minus 1.
I got to do the math, but I don't think it works.
I meant to say, wait a second, I screwed up. No, that'd be a 59. Oh, wait, no, that'd be a 70.
Yeah, you did add the 10.
I was right. Yep. I do good at math.
Okay.
I do multiplications and everything.
Yeah.
But I'll say something like, why don't you get down there and get that Peter all juicy?
That's sexy.
I tell her that, too.
Yeah, I bet you do.
I say, I'm gonna start giving it to you so damn fast and hard, you're going to think that somebody's drilling for oil down there.
And how does she respond? She likes that?
She gets crazy wet down there. It's yeah. Like, yeah, it looks like somebody took a swimming pool and built it around my bed or something. There's nothing worse, and I mean nothing worse, than a woman who thinks she knows what sexy is but doesn't. Or I imagine a guy, too, if you're a woman.
Yeah, yeah.
But it's like, shut the fuck up.
There are times a girl can completely take me out of the fucking moment by just saying, like,
dumb stuff.
Oh my, yeah. Just an one, oh my God.
It's like, poorly placed or just, you like...
Yeah.
One time I was with a girl and we weren't really ever vocal at all like that. Like we never did. And then, so the first time that she decides to be vocal, she just goes, it's so big. And like, I just started laughing. I just was laughing in her face. I'm just like, I said, look, it's fine. Like, don't ever do that again because it completely yeah. took me out of the moment.
Where did you meet her? On tinyhands.com? Dwarf hands.
By the way, Chester's Liver on feedback wants to know if Sam, talking dirty to his chick, just asks if his chick Jess just saw his latest O&A video on YouTube.
Oh,
did you watch it? Wasn't it funny?
Did you see the We Are the World video?
I produced and directed and edited.
Look how good I sunk up the audio.
Oh, I'm regular Peter Jackson. This is great.
I'll do that beforehand. Not during.
That's foreplay.
Yes.
You see that? I did that.
It's just one of those things, though, that they can really take you out of the moment just by, especially if it's somebody. Have you ever been in a situation where you kind of almost got to shut your eyes and think about somebody else?
The question is, have I ever not been in that situation?
Not only to come, but just to stay hard.
Yes.
Fucking A. And it's like, look. The girl I'm thinking about does not talk like you, so please shut your mouth.
The worst is when they keep pulling you out of the face. It's like someone talking during a movie.
Yes!
It's like, will you shut up?
Holy shit.
Stop talking.
Don't say a word. I'm almost done.
Your face and voice are ruining this experience. Excuse me. Your very being is spoiling me trying to come. So just be the human that I'm jerking off with. Because that's basically what you're doing.
Yeah.
I'm using your vagina.
Yeah.
You're a giant hand right now.
You're just taking care of it.
You're a big wet hand.
If it could live without you, I'd take a fucking pineapple corer and just rip it right out of your body and take it home.
That's why I'm not very vocal. I feel like I'll just sound silly.
Yeah?
Yeah.
You probably would.
I mean,
a lot
wouldn't.
Of sex talk does. I think I have to. I could not look into when you watch movies of like I think they did this like on The Matrix or something where you're fucking and they're coming at the same time looking at each other's faces as they're having mutual orgasm. If a girl looked at me while I was coming, she would phone 911 saying he is absolutely having a stroke. He is abso-fucking-lutely having a fucking stroke. I put on like a, yeah, Muggsy, meh. You could put a cigar in one half of my mouth and the other half's closed and meh, I'm coming, see? It's chitin's for you, dame. It's just, you don't want to look at my face when I'm coming, believe
me. 6 million coppers are going to come pouring out of my balls, see?
Yeah, see? Meh. My cock working like a heater. Yeah, like a Tommy gun, see? It really is. It's just like this half closed one side over. I'm like biting my lip. One eye shuts.
Yeah, exactly. I was about to say you should be smoking a pipe.
Popeye. I'm fucking. I'm a gangster. Edward G. Popeye. That's me. Olive oil. Shit. You can't make a. It's not like the movies. This romantic. Oh, face. It's just fucking, like, almost pain.
Sometimes when I come, I yelp like a bitch. I've done that a few times where I'm like, I'm coming, I'm like,
you're a faggot.
That's a great load.
Really?
Oh, if I yelp like a
Isn't
bitch,
a good one?
You have pulled every ounce of cum out of me. There's no more cum left. You've removed, you ought to nickname yourself the cum remover.
It taken. Yes.
Yes, I already registered that.
It's already my domain.
Yeah, that's, I don't know. It's not as pretty as it's portrayed in movies, or even the way some people talk about it. Like the sex talk thing. It sounds all great, and believe me, I would love to be better at it. But my repertoire is very limited. I'm like a retarded child's vocabulary. I don't have enough words. I don't have enough scenarios. It's just, yeah, that feels good. Ooh, oh yeah, oh God, I love the way you suck a cock. You know, you remember that one.
I do, but I remember it was so hard to say thank you. I wanted to be courteous and let you know that I was hearing you.
It's just so hard to come up with new lines.
I know. You know how a mad girl gets when she's sucking my dick and I go, "Is that as far down as you can go, pile?"
I broke out Louis Bean the other day. It didn't go over well.
You read John?
John? Oh, that's probably worse than Louis Bean's. Because yeah. He was serious there. You read John?
That was his moment.
That was his big moment.
Read John? And he really was asking somebody if they read with that sense of awe and wonderment. Yes. That could have been any moment in his real life. Yeah. You read, Monty? You read, you fucking fag?
You read, Rick?
No. Ooh. Somebody just broke wind.
Oh! Yay pudding.
Yay pudding. Mm. I can't do things for long. I get bored with them.
Yeah, I know.
Oh, I pulled a nose hair out by accident.
I would like to play the Rich Voss bit if we have that one, because it was very funny. We had, oh my God, what's his name? Completely mental block.
Chaz Palminteri.
In studio. We'll do this, and then, you know.
Well, you know, before we play this, I might as well plug.
Jimmy, please do.
I might as well.
You get it all set, Travis.
Tonight I'll be on Red Eye.
Yes.
And 12th, 13th, Chicago area. And also, my CDs, first two CDs are on iTunes. So,
yes.
Order them. They were doing pretty well.
Exactly. People love the Jim Norton.
Let's hope so.
Your HBO special was on Comedy Central.
Oh, good.
Yes.
Good, good, good.
Oh, actually, it wasn't Comedy Central. It was on one of the HBO comedy channels.
Oh,
so no shenanigans with the language.
Well, I think on Comedy Central, though.
The potty mouth.
I know. They'll show it late at night, I think.
On Comedy Central.
Saturdays.
How it works? Mm-hmm. On Saturdays?
Yeah, Saturdays.
Piak.
Backpack.
Where are you from?
Backpack. Westchester.
No, you're not.
New Rochelle.
You're from, like, fucking Pennsylvania.
No.
Like, not even Philly. You're from, like, the sticks of Pennsylvania.
Yeah. No, he's from, like, a shitty Jersey suburb.
Oh.
Like, fucking, what's the one begins with a V?
Verona?
Verona. No, there's one down in South Jersey. I had a threesome.
Voorhees?
No.
No?
Jason? No, that was Jason's mother.
Yes.
Jason wasn't a very good swimmer.
She was fantastic.
She sure was.
What a loon.
Hi, Mommy. Hey, Mommy. Kill them, mommy.
Love that one. Creep.
Their shitty Celine Dion hairdo. Her fucking, her dykey turtleneck.
A nasty fucking dead sun turtleneck.
Hi, what are you doing? How is this fucking Nordic chick killing everyone? Kill them, mommy.
Kill them. Yeah. No, where the fuck are we? Oh, Jim's plugs.
I'm done plugging.
Oh, okay. Anyone else? Sam, you got a plug?
Tune in to the Opie and Anthony show at tomorrow morning and every morning this week from 6 to 11.
At tomorrow morning and every morning.
Yeah.
That's great. That was good. Tune in to YouTube. We Are the World.
Yes.
Extravaganza video. Now, this is a video, and I defy anybody to say that this isn't the best We Are the World that has been done, and the best compilation of people.
And just big guest tomorrow, by the way. Floyd Mayweather.
Yes.
Fighter.
Oh.
We'll come in.
Big fighter.
Yeah.
Small
big
guy.
Big lug.
Big
fighter.
Yeah. Big mitts.
No.
For a small guy? No?
Small guy.
Just the fucking, one of them
fucking. I believe he's undefeated.
Yeah.
He is. He knocked out the Big Show.
Well. Did he?
Right.
Yeah. Did he?
Yeah.
Forgot about that.
Ugh. Big WrestleMania.
Your wrestling angle.
That's good.
Yeah.
Always good.
Fucking hate that you know so much about wrestling.
Why?
I don't know. It's just annoying that you're a child.
Oh my God! Speaking of wrestling, I almost forgot. Big superstars will be appearing at Monster Mania in a few weeks from now in Cherry Hill, New Jersey.
Oh wow!
I don't know how they secured these guys, but I haven't seen these guys appear in public in quite some time. So be prepared to see Al Snow, everybody.
Al Snow
with the head
and Greg the Hammer, not to be confused with the other Greg Valentine.
Wow.
Greg the Hammer.
What Greg a Valentine. Great golden egg you've just brought to this fucking program.
Now, because I wasn't psyched, but now I'm psyched.
Who else is going to be at Monster Mania?
Let's Malcolm McDowell.
Oh my God!
And,
oh,
yeah, no, Gary Busey, Pinhead himself, Doug Bradley,
Eric Roberts.
All I care about is Malcolm McDowell, Gary Busey. I love. Who else?
Eric Roberts.
Okay.
Who's Jake Busey
from Contact.
Living Dead 1 and 2. Jason Luke.
Corbin Burnson.
Corbin Burnson. Corbin Burnson.
Boy, the list really gets...
Meg Foster. Bill Moseley. You never see him at these conventions.
Meg Foster was in... Wait a minute.
There's a bunch of stuff.
I think she was in, like, a Star Trek episode. How old am that bitch?
She's old.
Wait,
she's
William Catt, the greatest American hero?
Oh, that's, my God, that Stern intern I see getting coffee
every
morning.
That's hilarious.
Shit.
I just recognized him for a second. I'm like, where do I know? Oh, in the bathroom. That's why I know.
Fucking hallway.
Stirring a hot chocolate 75 times precisely.
Al Snow has a publicity shot of him and Head.
Yeah.
How long ago is that now? Please tell me. How long ago was Al Snow and Head relevant?
I would say after 2000, you'd have to say not terribly.
No, not at all. He was done.
99 was probably the peak.
Is he wrestling for anybody these days?
No.
Tom Atkins.
Does Big Kev have any connections at this one?
Jill Whitlow.
Hook you up, I think.
Al Humphreys.
What's the date on this one? And I don't lie or I'll know.
It's 2 weeks.
Who are these people?
I'll be in Chicago.
I don't know these people.
Whoa, Power Man 5000.
Oh, live in concert.
Wow, they really are pulling out all the stops.
Do we have anybody going down there?
You're not excited for the Night of the Creeps reunion?
I'll probably go down.
Yeah, that I am excited about.
I thought so.
Joe Unger.
I have two things to be signed.
Bye.
No, but they can photos of me.
Oh, okay.
One with Gary Busey tickling me.
Oh. Yeah. Oh.
And one of Malcolm McDowell.
Mm. Well, I hope everybody has fun there. I shan't be attending.
Who's Dario Argento?
Who's Dario Argento? He's only the father of Italian
Suspiria,
horror.
Dawn of the Dead, 78. How about Masters of Horror?
Yeah, hello, opera.
How about Demons 1 and 2?
Jeez.
All right, Demons 2, I've seen.
How about I could read? Because I have no fucking idea who that is.
Why is Eric Roberts standing in front of Heath Ledger? Why is that the Dark Knight hero?
Oh,
what
did
he do in the Dark Knight?
What a fucking... Look at him using Heath Ledger's fucking Joker portrait. He was the guy in... He was the mob guy.
Yeah, Falcone.
Yeah.
Oh, okay. I like Eric Roberts, though. He's a fucking psycho in real life. He's a psycho.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think he's great.
Problems.
Well, I mean, he's just a ballsy maniac.
I think if Julia Roberts, like, fucked him up, the amount of fame that she had gotten.
Maybe, yeah.
When he was on his way up. He was definitely on his way up before her. Like, he had some key roles, and then she just fucking skyrocketed, and he went in the shitter.
Guys, we have a major guest.
Yeah,
on the
phone. Do have a major guest that we need to get to immediately.
Oh, Jesus Christ. Let's do it.
Line 10.
Caller?
Stat. Caller, are you there, caller?
Yes, I'm here.
Oh, my God. It is indeed the all knowing of these conventions. Big Kev, ladies and gentlemen. Big Kev. From Big Kev's Geek Stuff.
Yeah.
Yes, can I help you?
Big Kev, a lot of people have been calling in asking. If at the big convention, I'll be able to get my Malcolm McDowell photo signed.
Mm. Yes, of course you would.
Because I won't be there.
Oh, you want me to do it for you, Jim?
Whoever's going to be able to would be nice, as long as they care for it gently and gingerly with a lot of love.
Where is this one going to be?
You know that I will, Jimmy.
Yes, you will.
Yes, Cherry Hill.
He's very good. Cherry Hill?
Why so far?
What can you do?
Cherry Hill's, yeah. That's like far, yeah.
They don't come
it's like
you.
Going to Philly. It's like going to Philly.
You got to go to them. These fucking celebrities aren't going to come to you.
I want to be rich and have one of these in my house and then just have them all sitting around my house and walk by and just stare at them awkwardly.
Not invite anyone or sell any tickets or anything.
No, exactly. Just pay them.
Just book them to come to your house.
And just sit there. And they're like, this convention sucks.
I'm seeing, scroll through that again.
Okay.
I'm seeing Gary Busey.
Yeah.
Now, is Busey still as fucked up as usual?
Yes.
Yeah. Eric Roberts.
Yeah.
And Mark Patton from Nightmare on Elm Street 2. Was he a big guy or? I mean,
I don't really know who he is.
Yeah, I don't either.
He was in Nightmare on Elm Street 2, but
like,
that's all I know.
There is some Jake Busey from Starship Troopers.
Hey, you saw the movie. You know, The Wolfman was just in theaters.
Yeah.
Star of The Wolfman, Spencer Wilding.
Wait, I thought...
Huh?
I thought the star was...
Benicio del Toro.
But wait a minute, Spencer Wilding?
Yes, Spencer Wilding.
What a coincidence. Wilding is his last name.
It's wild. Like a werewolf.
Kev... Who is the biggest celebrity that is going to be at this convention?
I'd say...
Oh,
it's an homage to Opie.
We lost him.
No, we hung up on okay. Big Kev. Right,
no, that'll be my fault.
As he was right in the middle of...
Danny hung up on
that
Big
was my
Kev.
Idea, right, Kev?
Yeah.
It's going to be that scary, this thing. All this horror conventions.
Oh, don't be scared.
You're going to sell some cobwebs to people.
That's ridiculous. Well, look at that. We've actually gone the full distance.
Here's your hat. What's your hurry?
I want to play Rich Voss with Chaz Palminteri, who came in, graciously came into our studio to promote his then Broadway spectacle.
Yes, he did.
A Bronx Tale, which he did solo. Played all the characters himself. And Rich Voss came in, and we surprised him with a script and the chance to act with the great Chaz Palminteri. And what a bang-up job Rich Voss did with Mr. Palminteri. So we'll finish with that. Ladies and gentlemen, we will see you right here tomorrow morning on the Opie and Anthony program.
And you're welcome.
Robert De Niro.
It's not what you say, it's what he sees.
In his directorial debut.
We can't accept that.
Starring Chaz Palminteri.
I didn't give it to you, I gave it to your son.
And Rich Voss.
Louie, Beans, I want my money.
A Bronx Tale.
Beans, you can't dodge me forever.
Come on, what are you doing about? What are you yelling about, huh?
John, I got a problem with this guy over here, Louis Beans. This guy owes me 20, and it's been 2 weeks now, and every time he sees me, he keeps dodging me, John. Should I crack him one or what?
The struggle of an idiotic Jewish comedian stammering his way through a few lines of film dialogue with a genuine Hollywood actor.
Listen, see, sometimes violence is not the answer. Is he a good friend of yours or not?
Nah, John, I don't even like him.
Well, there's your answer right there. Look at it this way. It costs you $20 to get rid of him. He's never going to ask you for money again. He's never going to bother you again. He's out of your life for $20. Come on, you got him cheap.
Yeah, you're right, John. You're always right.
A Bronx Tale.
How do you know the right answer all the time, Johnny?
Well, I try to keep my eyes and ears open all the time. And I read.
You read?
Yeah, I read. Come on. Come on, let's go to Mario's next door and get something to eat.